Morris, thanks a lot for coming on the podcast from the start, someone we wanted to get on. This is pretty much typifies what our nights used to be in this gym, late night conversations, sharing stories, wisdom, experiences and that, but this time it feels a little different because we've got the cameras on us. When I think of you, Morris, and when I think about you on the sort of boxing scene, you're very well respected. You always present yourself in the correct manner. And I think people like that about you. You're genuine. But from you, like, you're always respectful. But from you, what's more important, to be successful or to be well respected?
I think obviously it's important to be successful if you're boxing. But it's more important to be well liked, you know, because people like people that are well liked and like working with them. If you're successful and arrogant, you know, it'll show in the long run. So I think it's more important to be well liked. And I've always been brought up in a sense of, you know, be a good person. I tell that, you know, to my children, I tell them, you know, when you're a good person, people like you, they work with you.
So I couldn't do a podcast with you without talking about Phil. And when you talk about those values that were brought into sort of your life, would you say Phil was responsible for some of them, or was it your upbringing as well as Phil?
Yeah, my upbringing, but, you know, Phil was important for, talking about my boxing career.
Yeah.
All my boxing career is more important now. Sometimes I talk about Phil, the way people see me kind of stepping to Phil's shoes to a point. They see me coming to his shoes, but not doing everything what Phil done, but being the same kind of person. Phil always gave me integrity and taught me how to be. He always pulled me up about a lot of things. He always pulled me how to be a person. You know, when we was growing up, he always, you know, he'd stop you. I remember once he was, we were going to a fight when he was amateurs, and the girlfriend stopped me and was walking there. Me, Phil, a few of the guys in the gym. And he stopped me and he said, she stopped me. And I said, listen, I don't want to talk to you now. You know what it is when you're fighting. Yeah. You don't want to talk to nobody. And I said, listen, I can't talk to you now. I'm going to fight, you know what I mean? What are you talking to me? And she goes, no, Morris, I need to talk to you. I said, what do I talk to him? Listen, leave it. And I was kind of shouting out like this because you're in a bad mood because you made weight and everything else. And then she goes, I think I'm pregnant. And I was like, what? That's what? Are you telling me that far now? And that kind of thing. And the way I went off, then Phil grabbed me by my throat, boy. Grabbed me by the scruff of my neck, I should say, you know what I mean? He said, don't ever talk to a woman like this. And he pinned me on the wall. I was like, I remember Phil's always been like that with me, though. You know, he took it a bit too, took me like it was his.
Yeah. Yeah. So I've heard all the stories, obviously, about Phil being a great trainer and a great man, but what sort of guy was he? What was his personality? Was he just tough? Was he a compassionate guy? What sort of guy was he?
I say, you know what I'm saying? Cruel to be kind.
Yeah.
That's Phil. You know, if it was everything you ever wanted to be yourself, and that's why a lot of people admired who Phil was. You know, everyone just wanted to be around him. I wanted to be around him 24 hours a day. And it's weird because I had a good relationship with my dad, but if I could choose, you know, he'd be my second dad 100%. Because Phil taught me a lot, especially the vulnerable times when you're growing up, you get to teenage, yeah. 13, 14, 15, 16, and you're kind of drifting. And I drifted in the gym, and Phil was there. And I didn't know at the time, but it turned out to be probably the best guidance I've had in my life.
Yeah. So when I think of Phil, I never met Phil personally. But do you think Phil took a sort of shine to you because he knew you wanted to be around him, you're willing to put the work in? Because the impression I get with Phil is if you put the work in and you're willing to make the sacrifices, he'd do the same for you.
Yeah, he said it exactly how it is there. That's exactly what I thought, you know, through time, you know, we had a saying in the gym, you know, all you had to do is turn up and train and you know you're winning a fight because Phil made us feel that confidence. He had something about him where, you know, everything that you'd done, no matter how hard it was, you know, Phil would always reassure you that, you know, because he used to come in the gym and say things like, you know, what's the worst feeling you can get? And we used to say, I don't know, red, horrible, nasty, horrible. Yeah. And he'd say, the worst feeling, what I can think of, the worst, is that you're going to die. and you're not going to die, are you? And he used to think about it. He used to really think about it all the time. He said it a few times to us. And we used to say, no, we're not going to die. And we used to go for it, you know what I mean? Just train hard and kill ourselves to the point. The good thing about the gym, everyone's in competition. And when you got a competitive gym and you always want to be number one, it's hard. It's hard work.
Yeah. It must have took a bit getting used to, because obviously, like you said, you come off the street, you're just a bit of a raw guy, you come in, suddenly this big intimidating man like Phil probably was at the time was telling you to do all this stuff. And it's amazing because you guys kind of was trusting in Phil from the off, really, weren't you?
Yeah, we didn't really have no other choice, really, because Phil was the main man. And the more he talked and the more we believed, the more experience we had with him, the more trust we had in him. If it was a one-off person, I never met anybody like him before. Yeah. You know, he just seemed to be, he looked the part, you know, he made us feel like we were the part. He always made us have strong belief in ourselves and anything was possible. We knew that with Phil, the impossible was possible. We always knew, we didn't even think about it, we didn't question it, you know, we just knew it.
So what were some of Phil's like training methods? I've heard the stories about running up the blocks of flats in over there in Hume and bringing the bar to the water park and doing the bar back there. And he was known as strength and conditioning and obviously getting you guys in tip-top condition. And also the time. Tell me about the time he made you run in the army boots.
yeah. So we were in the ABAs, in the amateurs, and, you know, the training was really, really hard. Really hard. So you got to the point, you know, when you're young, you just want to go out all the time and go clubs.
Yeah.
But you're sacrificing, you're in here training. And Phil made us live in this gym, 10 of us live in the gym. The first day was great. Everybody said a laugh, everyone in sleeping bags. Yeah. You know, it was great. Second day, it's okay, you know. They made us walk to his house, walk back, you'd meet us at the door, shut the shutters behind you. You couldn't, he'd weigh you in the morning, so you make sure that you're not eating at night time. And you know, anyway, after a week or two of that, you got really peed off with it, you know what I mean? So this went on. Every time you won a fight, you got to go in for another 2 weeks training in the gym. So imagine there's 10 people or 12, and then some would get beat, some would win. So then the next thing, there's 9 people, next thing there's 4 people, and this is every 2 weeks. And it got down to one person, it was me, because I kept winning. And it's flipping horrible, because you go in there and you're fighting and you win the fight. You can see on my face in some of the videos. You win the fight and you're like that, flipping neck. Because you know damn well you got to stay here for another 2 weeks.
Yeah.
So one day I got really peed off with it and I went missing and didn't turn up. He's kicking off. I knew he was going to kick off, but I went out and went down and I had me, you know, the Mars bars and everything else. And I come back and I was like, you know, like this. And he said, get them boots, uncle. Put the boots on, boy. And he was in trouble, man. And I was fighting like in a week and a half.
Yeah.
And he had to lose a lot of weight, you know? So he took me to, I was just in the car driving, you know, I'm in the car driving with him and I'm thinking, where are we going? You know what I mean? I'm looking further because I know I've got to come back. And he just keeps going down Kingsway, keeps going and going and going. I'm thinking, where are we going, man? I got to come back. And then he stops and says, get out, you're running back. And he runs with you, you know, so he drives the car to the side of you, playing the Rocky music. And you're running, you've got these army boots on, and they're heavy. I didn't know boots weighed so much. And you run like, and I was probably one of the best runners in the gym.
Yeah.
And I couldn't even make it. I think I got to Princess Road.
Yeah.
And I just went, that's it, but you lost about 9 pounds. You know what I mean? It's crazy, boy. Look who's calling now. Carl Thompson.
So, When I come to this gym, Morris, I'd been to a previous gym, so I knew this place was special. I walked in and I could feel it straight away. It just had this real special feel to it.
Yeah.
But for you guys, this is all you knew and Phil was all you knew. Did you know at the time he was part of something special? Did you know that Phil was a special man at the time?
No, I think he was, the more, like I said, the more we came, the more experience we had with him and the more trust we got with him. And I could see people that had been here before me and I could see what kind of relationship they had with him. And, you know, I knew in a very short space of time that this place is for me. I mean, I came to the gym not knowing that it was a boxing gym. I just knew that my friends were coming in, and I went in. I wasn't one of them guys that say, you know, I dreamt of being a world champion when I was a kid and all that. There's none of that going on with me. I didn't think about boxing at all. You know, I didn't say I'm handy with my hands, so I'm going to join a boxing club. I just happened to turn up to a boxing club, and it happened to be the best one, as far as I was concerned. Phil was there. It was like fate. You know, when I came here and I run away first day, and I come back, and, you know, Phil said, "You ready?" You know, and I said, "Yeah." And I knew straight away the sense of it. You know, you just knew that this is for me. You know, the way Phil was with you, it wasn't no favoritism. He's just like that with everybody, and even people that come through the door for whatever reason and go, he'd be like that with them as well. Everyone can tell you pure stories about Phil, not just me.
So when I hear you talk about Phil, and obviously knowing you all these years, if my definition of loyalty is you and Phil, you're intensely loyal to him. Mm. But I know Phil was loyal to you guys as well. Like, he had a lucrative offer to go and train a high profile fighter, but it wouldn't meant leaving the gym for a period of time. But he wouldn't go because of you guys.
Yeah, that's right. And we told him, we said to him, "Phil, go, we'll be all right." And he said, "No, my gym's here and my fighters are here." And we were amateur at the time. Some of them just turned over pro. But, you know, Phil, like you said, had that offer, and he said no. He said he's not going anywhere. And they wanted him. And he would have got a lot more money than what he's getting from us.
Yeah. So, obviously, since Phil passed, you've pretty much, I think it's fair to say, served your life keeping Phil's memory going and keeping the gym going. Is that out of the love and respect you had for Phil, or just a way of maybe trying to pay him back for what he'd done for you in your life?
Both, really. You know, there's no way I could, and this is me, and to be honest, this is probably what's keeping me alive. Nothing's wrong with me, you know what I mean? But I'm saying what's keeping me motivated and going, you know, and every day I wake up, I feel good. I don't feel bad at all. I think it was meant to be how it is. Like you say before, I wouldn't say Sir Phil. I was loyal with Phil because Phil was 150% with me, and I'm there's not one bad thing about Phil. One bad thing to say about Phil, nothing at all wrong. Everything he's done with me, done it for, he wants to win, he's got that in his heart. When Phil's shown us, when I first come to this gym, and the way our Phil was, I've never seen anybody like him. When he was in the corner, I've never seen anybody like him, so calm. I could be there panicking, and he just have this way about him, so calm, and he'd tell you the correct information, what you need to go and beat the kid in front of you. Yeah. And the more he done that, the more trust he got in him again. And I knew that he was a light heavyweight. I was a light heavyweight. And knew that he's putting his hopes on me. But people think that his favoritism was for me. But it was in a sense because I'd done everything he asked. I didn't do nothing. If he said to me, you know, jump that canal, you know what I mean? Swim that canal, I'd just say how many times. Yeah. I wouldn't question it. You know what I mean? If he said turn up here at this time, I'd be there 10 minutes before. I'd done everything. So, you know, army amateur career. I remember when my third amateur fight, I got beat and I was crying. And I remember he come in the change room and I was crying my eyes out. And he said, listen to me. He says, and he's giving me the reasons why I got beat, which I had never seen. I just thought I got beat because I wasn't good enough. But, you know, his experience, why I got beat on that third fight there. You know, when I come back the next fight, I won and we carried on right through. We had a great amateur career. Then Phil said it's time to turn pro now. And then we went pro. And, you know, I had all my fights with Phil, never lost once.
So you said Phil was a light heavyweight. He fought for the British title, didn't he? So when you look back, how proud are you that you managed to win the British title, you and Phil, from novice all the way through to the championship, and you got him that title that he never managed to win himself. How proud?
That's right. We are very proud. And like you said, you just touched on it there, from novice, which is rare to see with a lot of people. You know, I was with Phil in the amateurs when I came in the gym, and I was not boxing. I was just a normal street boy. And I came in there, Phil taught me everything. And, you know, right through the amateurs, won what I won in the amateurs. I turned professional, and I won what I won in. And I won a British title for him. And I say for him because he was a light heavyweight and he fought for the British title. And he got beaten in the British title, but it's something that he always wanted. I remember when I was fighting for it, and he said, he kept saying to me that, you know, I've got this box made on top of his fireplace, you know, for that belt to put on. I said, you ain't getting no belt. It's my belt. And he said, he really wanted that belt. He won all them other belts, but he really wanted that belt. And I'm so happy that I could do that for him.
So they say behind every great man's a great woman, and obviously Phil's wife, Audrey, I mean, she was here when I first started coming. She's a beautiful woman. And when I was coming, I was only a kid, and she always made me feel welcome and that. And I know she was supportive of Phil, and I know he spent a lot of time with Audrey. Unfortunately, Audrey passed away a few years ago, but I know that you kind of looked after her as well when she wasn't well.
Yeah, I mean, I couldn't pay Phil back enough, to say the truth. I couldn't, you know, for everything what he's done for me in my life. And, you know, it's only inevitable that I was going to do that. When Phil was passing, and, you know, I knew that's what I had to do. No one asked me anything, you know. I knew I had to be there, and I was there, you know. And Audrey was glad that I was there as well the whole time. It's just something that you do, you know what I mean? Just like I said, I was very loyal to Phil. Still, I'm very loyal, as you know. You know, I'm not leaving this place at all. And this is my life. This is this place ain't gonna make me no millionaire. It's not. But you know what I've got here is more than a millionaire in cash. You know, it's better than that. This just make me live. It's priceless.
Yeah, I mean, my kind of philosophy in life is happiness comes from what you do for other people. That gives you fulfillment. I think that's what you get from this place, but the loyalty that you've shown, that you've turned down high-profile opportunities and whatever else to keep this place open.
Yeah, that's right.
And over the years, I know it's not been easy. I know there's been struggles and stuff like that. And what people don't see about you is you can drive past here in the morning at 9 o'clock in the morning, maybe 10, and they'll see your car outside.
Maybe
12. And you drive past at 9, 10 o'clock, you still see your car outside.
Yeah,
and
yeah.
People come and use the gym, but I don't think they realise the work you put in behind the scenes. I know you've got a team, but you're the overall responsibility for the gym.
Yeah, and, you know, I mean, if you think about it now, it's nearly 30 years since Phil died, and his name's still buzzing on people's lips.
Yeah.
People still talking about him.
Yeah.
You know, he's a legend.
Well, for me, since I've been here, I've seen thousands of people passing and out the gym, and they've all been affected by Phil and what Phil's vision was and his hard work. Do you think if Phil obviously was still about, you think he would have ventured to something else apart from boxing, maybe politics, maybe something in the community?
Definitely. You know, when I first came here, Phil was involved in marches with, you know, liberations and, you know, for jobs and unions. And there used to be a lot of pictures in there with Phil organising marches and everything and speaking to politicians. There's pictures in there now of politicians coming here, you know, what Phil was involved in. So, you know, he was a very unique man, Phil. Whatever he put his mind to, he would do. And behind, like you said, behind every man is a good woman and his wife. You know, if you could ask Phil, he'd say his wife is the brain behind everything. Because she's a very smart person, Audrey, as well. She was in the same league as Phil, you know, head-wise, both of them.
Yeah, so as much as the sacrifices Phil made, Audrey probably made the same ones as well, didn't
100%,
she?
100%, yeah, because she was there. I mean, just with us. I mean, look, we used to go around to the house, you know, 12 guys. She's cooking breakfast for us, you know, cooking evening meals for us, dinner. Who wants all these shitty guys coming, all the shit getting to the house in the morning? You know what I mean? When you're getting up and you got to, you know, he's in a house there. Like he said, there's a thing, his interview where Phil could have said, look, I could have bought the property here, but, you know, look, we've got a gym, we've got this place, it's all right. You know what I mean? And I was just saying, I want a house, you know, I want to buy a house. And he's putting us up, doing all kind of things, spending his money. He's going out, you know, I remember Phil, we used to go out in a week to boxing shows, and Phil always took me. And we always went out to, you know, Birmingham, Gloucester, London, all these different places far away just to watch the fighters. And Phil would videotape. Phil's the first man I seen with a videotape, and he videoed all of them just so we got them, because we're going to be fighting them one day. And he'd done this every single week. And we used to come back late, 2 o'clock in the morning. We got training at 7. come back 2 o'clock in the morning, he'd stop in the petrol station, and he'd buy Audrey a bunch of them cheap flowers, you know what I mean? And then he'd say, he'd always give me that talk about, listen, he'd always say, have you got a woman? Maurice, have you got a woman? And he'd say, then he's going about, listen, his favorite saying was, he'd go, listen, if you got a woman, ask yourself this question, would you die for her? He goes, and if the answer is yeah, marry her. That's what he said all the time. He said it every single time went away with him, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Phil was a top guy, I tell you. He'd do the same thing. I kind of know what he's going to say. When he said, have you got a woman, Maurice? He blared at me all the time. Have you got a woman, Maurice?
So at the time, probably the late 80s, early 90s, yeah. Moss Side had its troubles, but the gym was kind of like a beacon of hope for people within the area. I imagine it must have been frustrating for Phil when he's looking out onto the streets and he's seeing these misguided sort of youths getting up to no good, where he knew that he had the capabilities of obviously turning their life around. Mm. I mean, would he many people from the streets sort of coming in here and would he train and would he trying to turn their lives around?
Yeah, that's what Phil, that's what this place was really. It's like a beacon of hope really for a lot of people. You know, many people knew it was here. A lot of people scared to come in here, but people that did come in here knew that it was right. You know, people think it's the middle of Masai, so people think it's a predominantly black gym. It's nothing to do with that. Everyone was coming in here. Every race was coming in here, you know, and no one didn't care about anybody. Yeah. There was no color code in here, you know what I mean? There was no move yourself and all that business, you know what I mean? I'm running things, I'm from Masai. None of that going on. If you're out there, you know, Phil used to say, you know, they do what they do and we do what we do. Yeah. There's nothing at all like that going on. You know, people came in here and they knew it was hard work. It smells of hard work, even now. It just smells. You know a proper gym when you get in a proper gym. Yeah. And we never had none of that. We never tolerated no rubbish, no guns or anything at all like that. It was all left outside.
Yeah, and Phil was quite firm with that.
Very firm.
He was quite a fearless guy, Phil, wasn't he? It was kind of his rules. He wouldn't sort of bend them for anyone.
Yeah, people come in here and tried it with Phil. You know, we've been here. I remember once when we were all in here, the lads were in here, and Audrey, his wife, used to take the money, the subs, at the door there, and it'd be on the table, and two smackhead guys came in and grabbed the money and gone, you know what I mean? So we found out who they were a couple of days later. So Phil rounded us all up, put us in the minibus. We went down to the area where they were, found them, dragged them in the bus. We beat the shit out of them in the bus, right? then they come upstairs. So Phil got him upstairs, and Phil's gone, never seen like this before. And he's gone, go upstairs and get the bar. I said, which bar? Said, get the fucking. He's just gone mad. He's never seen Phil like that before. And he's got his iron bar. He's come down. Everyone's like, never seen Phil like this before. And Phil's gone, listen, right? He's got the guy, and the guy's like this. Phil's got him by his neck, and he goes, if my wife struggled there, what you doing? You would have beat my wife, wouldn't you? And he's going, no, no, no. So Phil says, you know what I'm going to do to you now? He goes, please. Can you imagine what happened, right?
Yeah.
Right in front of us, yeah. And it weren't pretty either. It wasn't pretty at all, boy. And then everyone was watching. We was holding him, and then he got the same as well.
Yeah, he didn't suffer fools, did he?
And have a guess what? They come back a week later, said they wanted to train here.
Did he accept the men?
No.
His kindness didn't stretch out.
They're on gear, man. You know what I mean? Yeah. Them guys don't feel nothing, man. You know, you beat them guys, man. They don't feel nothing.
Yeah. So tell me, I mean, Phil was a bit of a master psychological sort of play. Tell me the story of Ted Kershaw and Enzi Bingham.
Yeah, Ensley. So back in the day, because we were Masai'd and we were beating these guys who were boxing for England and were established, that wasn't supposed to happen. We were like new kids on the block and coming beating these guys, and they didn't like it at all. So they had this one called Ted Kershaw, who was like the number one England boy, light middle, and he was going places, he'd been everywhere. He's like the blue-eyed boy. And we came across him with Enzi got picked to fight him in the ABAs. So we know what Enzi's capable of, you know. We know what Enzi's capable of, his bad body shots and head shots, everything. Anyway, so they went to the weigh-in, and they know what Enzi's capable of as well. So he went to the weigh-in, and we're at, the main noise used to be over there, the city's ground, right? So he boxed in there. So we all went there. We all, when we turned up to our show, we turned up like in hoves, you know, like 20 people. It's kind of intimidating. We're all street boys, you know, end of the day. So we go there. Ensley gets on the, sorry, Ted Kershaw gets on the scale and he's bang on the weight and he's like this. And then Ensley gets on the scale and we're all around him. Them days could get around him. So Ensley's got like a weight in his underpants, you know what I mean? So when he gets on the scale, now he's like 8 pounds overweight. So they don't want to fight Ensley at all because they know what he's capable of. So they're rubbing their hands like that. And he's going, yes, he's not made the weight. And Phil goes, bring Ensley in the toilet. And he goes, bring them two bottles, the orange one and the white one, the clear one, bring them in. So we all go in the toilet and they're all like this looking, what's it on about bringing the toilet? And he comes out to take the weight out of Ensley's sack. Now, goes back out in 2 minutes, gets on the scale again. And they're looking like that. Bang on. So said, he's like, yeah, fucking cheating. You're fucking looking win again. They're going absolutely crazy. But just playing mind games and bending them over, you know what I mean? Because we know what Enzo's going to do with him. Anyway, Enzo went out there. And honestly, Enzo, there's a picture over there. You see it?
Yeah, yeah.
I'd say, yeah, boy, Enzo beat the shit out of this guy, man. Bad, bad, bad. And back then, because Phil always gives us that philosophy that you have to knock him out.
Yeah.
Otherwise, he's not getting decisions, you know what I mean? Even then, it'll be a draw.
Yeah.
So, Enzi put him down 3 times, I think. He could knock. Woohoo! Is that Phil? They could not. He could have put that one in.
That's an 18 stone.
Carl Thompson. Carl Thompson will laugh with that one.
Has it gone that low down? No.
He just went down like that, boom. Jeez, man.
I knew I shouldn't have had that chair.
Get some more chocolate, man. You ain't gonna start that story again, ever.
Gotta go in the outtakes,
huh? Where did it finish? I've seen that. Because Ted Kershaw there, man, he, you know, back then, you know, you had to knock him out of saying that, wouldn't you?
Yeah,
you had to
knock him
out to get a draw. But we was there waiting for the chairs. We were waiting for chairs 11 minutes to referee and bump them in the ring, you know what I mean? So, you know what I mean? In case they made it a draw and they gave it to Ensley.
So you mentioned that when you go to the shows, it was like an event. Everyone would go down together. What were them times like? Because I think, remember you telling me in a time, like sometimes you go to Newcastle and you're all kind of going different cars and that. And it sounds like a good laugh.
Yeah, it was because none of us couldn't drive. Yeah, we all had the higher cars, you know what I mean? So I feel knew what was going on, but you know, it just from my side out with these kids.
Yeah.
And, so we all went down there to Newcastle and it was more a laugh, it was more like a team. And we went down there, we were my side team, we were fighting these kids from Newcastle and their place. And we all had to come in the gym, in the ring at the beginning of the fight. And we was all like, we just street boys, you know, really trying to get some manners on us.
Yeah, yeah.
And discipline. And we come in the middle of the ring and we're talking to the boys and I'm saying, I'll fucking kill you. You know, we try and intimidate them back, you know what I mean? All that kind of stuff. And it worked. And every one of us knocked them out.
Yeah.
Knocked every single one of them out bad as well, you know. Really, really good night that.
So you talk about having to knock them out basically to pretty much get a draw.
Phil made us do that, Phillips.
How did it feel though if you got a bad decision? Was it disheartening or because you're half expecting it? Was it like the system's kind of done us again?
Yeah, I mean, I got beat. In my amateur career, I had 65 and lost 5. But I think out of them 5, I think I definitely lost 2 or 3 of them. Definitely lost 2 or 3 of them, you know what I mean? Mm. But two of them, I won. And the reason why I say they won, and they know this as well, one was Eric Noy, if he's watching this. Eric Noy. Because Eric, what happens is, when you're amateur and you're going to fight, and especially in ABAs, you always wear them England vests if you box for England. Because straight away, the judge looks at you like that, so you're already 2 rounds up. Yeah. You know what I mean? Out of 3. So Eric put on his England vest, and I beat up Eric, and Eric got the decision. So Eric got the decision, but the week after, who comes knocking on the door to join the gym?
Yeah.
Eric Noy. So that tells me then, he knows, Eric, you know, boy. And the other one was another guy called Mark Khan. And he had the England vest on, me and him fighting, and he got the decision. A week later, who comes knocking on the door? Mark Khan, to join the gym. So you know, you don't come and join somewhere where you're getting beat. No. You know what I mean? If you're feeling like you're better than them, you can carry on.
But how would you feel like when you got that bad decision? Is it something you would take really bad, or is it something you would kind of talk to Phil and you say, well, we know how it works and let's move on to the next one?
Well, we knew how it worked. We knew how it worked because back then it was more racist. Mm. The establishment was more racist. And,
yeah.
You know, I'm not going to sit here and ponder around it and say that it's not. It was more racism going on then, you know. Back in the day, there's a lot more racism going on, regardless of anything in life. When we were here, there was, out of the team, there was a lot of black people, you know what I mean? And obviously the white guys as well, and Asian as well, you know what I mean? But I think it's the area more, you know what I mean? I just presume that all people in the area are black.
Yeah.
So when we got picked to go to the England squad training or places like that, you know, we'd all turn up there. Most of us were black. And, you know, they turn up on it. And I remember Kevin Ike,
yep.
Nigel Travis, and a few of them were there, you know what I mean? And I remember one time they were saying, they were showing us this video of these guys and these Africans in this African nation. And these African nation guys going boom, 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 knocking out these guys. And I was like, what? You know what I mean? And, you know, Kevin Nicky said, what's going on with these guys? How come they're so tough? How come they're knocking everyone out? So we were just like, Phil was there as well, and we were just like, don't know, you know what I mean? Yeah. They're strong and tough, or eating good, you know what I mean? Or something. So we was like, he's like, well, what is it? Go on, tell me, what is it? So we was like, don't know. So he goes, is it because they're swinging in them trees and banging into them coconuts? And we were like, you what? And like Tony Kubia, you know, a couple of guys are African there. They got up and Phil went like that. You know what I mean? Don't say nothing. Just so we can get picked.
Yeah.
Don't say nothing, you know what I mean? Just have it. So with that intel as well, in turn, we, you know, we just want to fight a bit more. And that's what made us a bit more angry, because we knew what he was fighting against, the establishment kind of thing. You know, we weren't getting picked. We're number one in the country and you're not getting picked for things, you know what I mean? And you're thinking,
When I think of that, I think it probably brings you together a bit more. Wrongly, it probably brought you together and you thought, you know what, we got something to sort of...
Probably did. You know, back in the day, it was wrong, you know, the stuff that was going on. Probably people had worse things than that done to them. But that was what was going on with me. And that's why I'm not, you know, I'm not backing down from nothing, because that's what happened.
Yeah. No, it must have been tough back then. And I know that, like, you was in contention sort of a one time to go to the Olympics, got to the ABA final, didn't you? And you obviously fly in. And I think, was that when you're going to the England camps, when you're hoping to go to the Olympics and get picked? And
yeah, I was going down there, going Crystal Palace. Shake.
Yeah.
No, they wasn't picking me for nothing. I remember calling Phil, and Phil said, they're just using me here. And Phil said, you know what, just get your stuff and come. And then he said, right, we're going pro. And that's it. You know,
I remember when I went down in the amateurs, Ozzy said the same thing. He said, look, watch yourself down there. He says, they're not the most stand-up guys, you know, just...
Ozzy was with us as well.
And I imagine Ozzy was very strong about it, so Ozzy would have experienced the same. But didn't he have your hands tied behind your back at one point?
Yeah, they tried that rubbish with... I sparring with
Akinwunmi
Akinwando, I sparring with him. And I said, put your hands behind your back there and tied it. And Henry Akinwunmi is a heavyweight.
Yeah.
That big, long heavyweight as well. And our heads go... Bzz, bzz, bzz. And I kept thinking, this ain't right, boy. This ain't right. I tell him, I'm on my own over there in Crystal.
Yeah.
So I called Phil, and Phil said, you know what? Get your stuff, come back. You know what I mean? And that was that. Yeah. So I said, forget that rubbish, man. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
I said, you got to move your head. Move my head.
Yeah, done similar.
Nonsense, man, yeah.
Done similar. Me, I get my head chopped off down there.
That big heavyweight like that.
Yeah. So recently, like last couple of years, Phil's been getting sort of the recognition that he probably should have a long time ago, where he's obviously had the painting in town, which he got voted for. I mean, as with you that day, it's obviously a proud moment. And then the documentary, which has been a big hit with everyone. It was an absolutely fantastic story. I mean, did you enjoy watching that back? Plenty of memories?
Yeah, Bob. It brought back a lot of memories, to say the truth.
Yeah.
All the footage is in the cupboard in there, because Phil, like I said, Phil was one of the first guys I seen with a video camera.
Yeah.
And he absolutely documented everything. Yeah. We used to wonder why he used to do it, but he used to document everything. And when we look back on there, you look back and we see the laughs and everything else we used to have. And, you know, it just reminds you about the good old days, you know.
Yeah.
Sounds bad that they're in the good old days.
I've watched it three times. I don't mind admitting the first two times I had a tear in my eye watching it. It's very emotional sort of seeing you on it and seeing Joe and sort of what it kind of meant to you and that. It was really engaging.
Yeah.
But also there's talk of a statue for him in the kind of local park over there.
Yeah.
I mean, how proud would you be if there's a statue erected?
Oh, Phil. Because so much people that have passed through in that time with Phil.
Yeah.
I don't know any bad stories.
No.
If there is, I've never heard them. You know, but I don't know any bad stories for one person. And everybody seems to recognize him. And recognize a good, what he's all about. So a statue before filling for him, you know, it'd be fitting for him, I should say, you know, because that's the least he deserves. You know, to me, he put my side boxing on the map, you know, and there's nothing else going on. I remember there's a guy called Lance Lewis that Phil used to train with when he was boxing. And I remember saying to Lance was saying to us, like, Phil said, how come there's no boxing gym here in my side? He's no... These deprived areas is probably where the best fighters come from. So Phil had the head on it and the economic space to do it all. And he did, and he used his head. You know, he got the money, funding from the council, well, not from the council, from different various bodies. But he used his wisdom to get where he got to get to. And, you know, he's very resourceful, Phil.
You said that Phil put Moss Side Boxing on the kind of map. I think it's bigger than that. So I always obviously look at what Brian Hughes done over there with Collierst and Moston. But Phil had a massive influence. So the people that come through here, Billy Graham, obviously Joe Gallagher. Mm-hmm. Every gym you seem to walk in nowadays has got a bar in it. I went to a gym in Tenerife, it had a bar in. He just had a massive influence on everything, didn't he?
Yeah, Phil started that bar bag in here, and should have bought rights on that, me, to tell you the truth.
Yeah.
If he started a bar bag in here, and it was, you know, it turned out to be a success. I mean, a lot of people do the bar bag now and put their own device to it, but how it's meant to be, it was meant to be, you know, you do 40 jumps in a minute.
Yeah.
The device, great, you know, you do 40 jumps in a minute, and you work that bag as hard.
Yeah.
You know, just like a boxing fight, and Phil said that's the closest you're gonna feel to a round in boxing, doing one round in boxing. And it does, it works hard, you know, because if you do more than 40 jumps, great, you know, but you gotta work that bag hard and you gotta keep your hands up.
And we still use the original one, don't we, the original bars, bar bag?
Two of them are still there.
And they're the bars that you used to take down to sort of Chilton Water Park and then have running around and jumping them.
Imagine that, you put a bar in a van, you know, what we used to have.
Yeah.
And you used to take the bar with us to the water park and you set it up on the two gates.
Yeah.
And you hold it, you have to jump the bar.
Yeah.
That was hard, we were sprinting around the water park.
So the training mustn't have been for everyone. It weren't like a magic cure in that you come and suddenly feel make you a great fighter. You had to put the work in. There must have been a lot of guys that come to the gym wanting to improve themselves and then obviously had to kind of leave because they couldn't hack it.
Yeah, you know what, funny enough, the boxing, the bar, you know, people came, but because... Like I said, it was competition in the gym and people seemed to be doing it.
Yeah.
And they could see and sense, you know, it's like a great aura in the gym.
Yeah.
You know, and people just wanted to be part of it. When you come in the gym, you know, you couldn't sit still. You had to join in. So that, you know, in here it's competition. Everybody wants to be number one.
Yeah.
Anything they're doing, whether it's running, whether it's more jumps on the bar, whether it's faster on a circuit, you know, whether it's sparring, anything at all, they want to be number one. And that's what you got when you got in here. A lot of people joined this gym because of that. Because, you know, back in the day, people weren't training, like you say, conditioners and things like that. That's all separate to boxing. We were doing a lot. Mm. We were doing everything. Phil always had his mind focused on us. And all he said we had to do is hard work. Hard work beats everything.
Yeah.
You know, there's no cutting corners. You know, I notice some people got machines now, and obviously they got condition. I'm not saying it ain't the right thing to do, but you can't beat hard work, and I go with that.
There used to be a sign up here long before Mayweather said it, hard work and dedication will change your life.
Phil had it up there, it's still there now. It's just covered up in plaster. And he said that from back then, hard work and dedication. And there's a big poster there saying it long time before Mayweather.
So tell me the story about when Phil brought some fighters over and their manager tried to shortchange the fighters. And Phil was all about the fighters, wasn't he? He was not going to let anyone get underpaid. He weren't looking to let the manager take the money. So he rounded a few people up and kind of went and collared them at the airport, was it?
Yeah. So we were pro by then. And we sent this team came over from America. So we built it like Bronx versus Marseille, two rough areas kind of thing. So they came over. The kids were all right. We beat them all. Everyone got a win. And this manager, or trainer, what he was, he's supposed to be handling the money. So when he got the money, he didn't give the fighters. Only Phil found out by accident, you know, because one of the guys came and said, you know, instead of getting paid that, could I get this in the bank instead? Yeah. And he said, what are you talking about that? There's a lot more than that, you know what I mean? And they realized, and the trainer was having them off. So Phil found out. So in the morning, they were going to, they're going home on a plane. So Phil's got up in the morning and met them at the airport in the tunnel. So, the video camera's there because Phil had to document everything.
Yeah.
And Phil starts filming it. Someone starts filming him. Phil's got him up by his, you know what I mean? Yeah. And the guy's like, no. But the bad thing is now he took the money off him.
Yeah.
Phil, give it to all the fighters. And they all got to go on a plane with him.
Yeah.
So whatever happened after that was their business, you know what I mean?
Was Phil a big guy? He's light heavyweight. Was he a tall guy?
Yeah, Phil was 6'2". Phil was 6'2", yeah, big. But Phil had this look on him where he knew you didn't come mess around with him.
Yeah,
you know, he had this look and he just knew that Phil, you know, whatever Phil says goes. And you couldn't play around with him. He's not stupid.
Yeah.
You know, he wasn't born last night, as the saying goes. He, you know, he just knew you couldn't play around with him. And if he says black, that's black. If he says white, that's white. You know, you couldn't play around with him. You couldn't call it grey, you know what I mean?
Was he quite fit, Phil? Did he join you for runs and stuff like that? Was he still quite active?
Yeah, at the beginning, Phil was, you know, but he knew he couldn't keep up with us in the end.
Yeah.
It was impossible,
yeah,
you know.
Yeah.
So, I mean, I remember once I was in the ABAs, I think, and I didn't have no sparring partners, and Phil put the gloves on, and it's one of the worst feelings I've had with Phil.
Yeah.
And he sparred with me, and I'm like, boof, boof, and I'm catching him in his cleaning his nose. And I'm thinking, I can't punch this guy. It's like punching your dad.
Yeah.
And that's the feeling you got with it. I think I can't punch him. And he's going, boof, boof. He's got that look on his face still. And you're thinking, I can't do this to him. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
But, you know, he just got in with us.
So your amateur career, when was it time to have your first fight? How long had you been training? Did you feel ready? Or did you just trust kind of what Phil said?
What do you mean? First,
your first amateur.
Yeah, I was. I didn't have a clue. I've never done anything like this before. So you know yourself, first time you're drying in.
Yeah.
Jeez, man, there's never been anything like that in my life, boy. I tell you. And Phil said, listen, when you brush your teeth, you know, make sure you spill every little drop of water and don't swallow nothing. Yeah. I'm like this. So when I'm brushing my teeth, I'm like. You don't know better, do you?
No.
I tell you, boy, and you feel like shit, man, because, you know, any fighter, you know the first feeling you get there, it's horrible. You feel like a greyhound, but I tell you, you're just like, you feel weak as anything. And then I said to Phil, I feel weak. I can't fight, I feel weak. He said, it's only a feeling, because you used to have this thing saying, it's only a feeling, it's only a feeling. And then you fight, and then, I knocked him out in the first round, his kid. I never knocked anyone out before.
How'd it feel?
I felt like, I didn't know what was going on. I was just how did that happen? You know what I mean? Because I've never seen anyone go days like that. And then I had a second fight and knocked him out as well. And I thought, this is tough, bro. I tell you, I like this game, boy. And the first fight, I got beat. I got stopped in the second round.
I was going to ask you about that. So that third fight, how did it feel? Because did you have a sense of impending doom, like you knew it was going to happen?
Yeah, I knew it was going to happen. Yeah, Dan, I'd say, before I went in there, I knew it was going to happen. So I was fighting this guy who was an England boy. I was in the ABA, so I got drawn against him.
Yeah.
You know, he has 75 or 85, you know, must have knocked out most of them.
Yeah.
And I knew when I was walking in there, this ain't going to go long, boy. Not in favor of me.
Yeah.
And I come out there and ding, ding, round one. And I don't know how I survived the first round, but I did. And I was shitting myself to go out in the second round. And I got up in the second round. I feels like, get your jam going. It's like that. Fuck it. Fuck it. And he must have thrown some big over and right both. And I was susceptible to them. And the next thing, I was just like, down, boy. Referee. Good thing is, in them days, referee is cool. The referee just like, see a little punch, see you go down, just stopping it.
Yeah.
So I went, nice, man. And the guy in the changing room was crying my eyes out, man.
Is that the one I found the video for? I think I sent it to you on WhatsApp. One. It took me a long time.
Which one was that now?
I found, which one did they have, where, did they put it on TV or something? One of your amateur fights?
No, that was another one. Jeez, boy. Jeez, boy. I was thinking that. So what happened there? In that one, I was in the ABAs again.
Yeah.
And fighting Johnny Melford, wasn't I?
Yeah, that's it, yeah.
It's on YouTube now, yeah. So I said to everyone, yo, I'm fighting, man. I'm on BBC One. Watch me. I told everybody, every single person in the world, I said, I'm fighting BBC One.
Yeah.
Make sure you watch it. Jeez, man. Couldn't have gone worse in my life, man. I tell you, the guy, again, big over and right, boof. Went clean out the ropes. okay, I got back up and I got this look on my face like, cheeky bastard, like, like that. Referee told me to wipe my gloves, man. And he says, that's it, it's over, because they'll stop you.
Yeah,
they'll stop you, don't they, you know what I mean? Quick. So I said, what do you mean talking about? But I was still a bit gone, to tell you the truth, you know what I mean? And I was just doing that because that's what he's supposed to do. What are you talking about, ref?
Yeah,
what are you talking about?
Yeah.
But, you know, a referee, he stops it, man, and that's the end of that. And this Johnny Melford, man, I've seen him since. He's cool.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You boxed your cousin, didn't you? In the Hutchers. Yeah. How did that go?
It was good, really. I don't really like him anyway. But he was all right, the guy, you know what I mean? But I don't really check for him.
Yeah.
So I boxed him, and he got some tough head, boy. I think he knew that I didn't like him.
Yeah, yeah.
And I beat him good as well. You know, yeah. I remember hitting him hard with your knuckles, boy. I remember hitting him good.
Yeah.
Yeah.
How did your family feel about you starting boxing? Like your mum, was she happy or was she against your boxing?
No, mum was against. When I was boxing amateur, she was fine.
Yeah.
But when I turned pro, when I said to him turning pro, she wasn't happy at all. My dad was cool.
Yeah.
But my mum, I said to her mum, I said, I'm turning pro. And she went, oh no, you're not. No, Jamaican women. Oh no, yeah. you're not turning pro. No. Mm-mm. So I said, I am. She goes, no, you're not turning professional. You're not turning. So I went back to the gym, and about a week later, Phil said, we're having a fight tonight. You know what I mean? So
yeah.
I said, good. And he said, I think it's getting 500 pounds or something like that. I was like, what? You know, because 500 pounds, me.
Yeah.
I'm getting trophies. You know what I mean? I want money.
Yeah.
So I was like, yes. So went out to fight, dealt with that, come back, went home. Mum didn't know nothing. I said, Mum. So I went, look, boom. So I said, this is £300. And she went, where's that from? I said, I turned pro. Here's some money. And she went, ooh, it's not bad, this, is it? I mean, and that was that.
Your mum becoming your promoter. Pro,
mum's the biggest fan, you know what I mean? Yeah. Every time I was fighting, man, how did he get on? It was my dad, how did he get on? You know what I mean?
Jeez, man,
she didn't change her mind. Yeah, she's cool, my mum.
Yeah. The decision to turn pro, why was that taken?
Because I wasn't getting picked in the amateurs.
Yeah.
You know, I was winning everything and it wasn't picking me.
Yeah.
And then the Olympic thing came where they said, you know, Phil said we're going to wait around for the Olympics. I was one of the last ones in the gym to turn pro.
Yeah.
And then Phil said, they written a letter. I got a letter home still in the Olympics and they said they're not picking me. So Phil says, number one.
Yeah.
Why are you not picking him? He goes, and they said, because I haven't got experience. So Phil written a letter back saying, well, if you don't pick him, we'll never get experience. You know what I mean? And so a big argument going on like that. Then Phil said, fuck him, we're turning pro, and we did.
How did that feel? Is it something you had your heart set on? Like, because obviously Phil was holding you back.
Yeah, I was waiting around, and everyone turned pro, and I seen the lucratives what they were getting, and
yeah.
You know, money especially, you know what I mean? I'm still getting these daft plastic trophies and smiling.
Yeah.
And I'm looking at it thinking, I want some of that. Yeah.
So then you turn pro, and you fight for the British title in your 11th fight. I mean, that's quite soon. You can't really see fighters doing that nowadays. How did that come about? And was that something like, because when I think of the old Champs Camp days, it was when the opportunity comes, you got to take it because it might not come around again. Was it a case of that?
Yeah, well, because Phil said, you know, no one's going to become, you're not going to be promoted like these guys who have been to the Olympics or got a successful name in amateurs. So you got to do it the hard way.
Yeah.
So basically wait for the phone to go. And when the phone goes, you better be ready. So Phil always said, you've got to be in the gym training. So we was in the gym training every single day, beating.
Yeah.
And I was in there every single day training, but we were ready. So when the phone did go, you know, it says a fight in 2 days' time or the same night, we'd be ready to go. You know what I mean?
Did you feel ready or was you a bit apprehensive?
Well, you're talking about...
Yeah, the British title fight.
Oh, no. I was ready for that. I knew what was going on then.
Yeah.
I knew that was going to go on because I worked my way up. You know, I started and I took... There was a fight which puts you in the mix.
Yeah.
And the fight that put me in the mix was my third fight against Nicky Piper.
I was going to get onto that, yeah.
Right. So... And I took that fight the same day notice, next day notice, whichever it was. And I went over there and I got a draw with him.
Yeah.
But that's what puts you in the mix then. Yeah. You know what I mean? Because then people start recognising who you are.
I was going to say, you had a tough route to your 11th fight because Nicky Piper at the time, he's a big puncher.
Yeah.
Everyone fancied him to go places. And I think, like you say, you got it on the same day or the day before notice. And when you turned up, was it evident when you turned up that you're fighting the next sort of big star they're trying to push through?
Jeez, words. So yeah, I didn't have a clue in Nicky Piper as well until I got there and I seen Barry McGuigan and I seen a few of the guys come running up to me.
Yeah.
And I shoved the mic in my face and I was like, is it, you're fighting Nicky Piper? What's it? And I was like, who? What? Huh? You're talking about, you know, that kind of thing. And then,
yeah.
And then, then we come out ding ding. I never seen Nicky Piper before in my life. And I seen this guy looking at me like he knows me, like he's upset with me or something at the corner. I was thinking, and then I come out ding ding round one, and I threw this lazy jab, and you're like, bang, that big right hand over the top.
Yeah.
And I've gone down, and I'm looking at Phil, looking at him, and he's like, no, come on, like, ready to knock me out. And I can hear the commentators go, oh, and Cole's gone down. This might be Nicky Piper's fastest win to date, and all that kind of thing. And I'm like, jeez, man, the crowd are going, whoa. So I got up and I got through that round. And I thought, Phil got in the corner and said, you all right? I said, yeah, I'm all right. I said, what's going on? So Phil told me some things. Went out there again, started the boxing. Yeah. And everything I tried, my Nicky Piper had answered for. And I kept wondering why or how. Then I went right onto the body. And I remember my hand was falling short and he went both with a big left hook and I gone, buff. And I've gone down again. And I've gone, jeez, what's going on? And I just kept thinking, how this guy got me measured like this, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
I mean, I realized that he obviously been training for me, you know what I mean? But
yeah.
Anyway, so I got back to the corner. There you go, this is the trainer now. He sat me down and he said, listen to me. And I remember him saying, fuck this crowd. And excuse the pun. And he goes, fuck this crowd and fuck this. And he said, boxing. And he told me what to do. And he told me exactly what to do. Yeah. And he just straight away, you just think about what you can do and what I've done in the gym and everything else. And that round onwards, I beat him. From that round onwards, I beat him and shook him up, you know what I mean? And I just boxed my way through it. Bam, bam, give him some good boxing. And I could hear the commentators saying, you know, Maurice Cole's really coming to this now. He's giving him a boxing lesson and bam, bam, bam. And that was it. So we'd gone through and then, I had a draw, you know, flipping eye was cut, everything, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
But, you know, the guy trained for me. I had a day's notice, you know what I mean? So I remember an interview that said, because he was like, oh, you got a draw, you know? I was saying, listen, he said, would you fight him again? I said, yeah. I said, with a bit of notice next time, though, you know? I remember that saying that, you know what I mean?
But he didn't fancy it again. I think the fight tried to get made, but he didn't fancy it again.
Yeah.
But when you got put down and you looked to the corner and you see Phil and you go back, how reassuring was that? Like, this is a man you trust with your life, and he's giving you the advice to get up, and he's giving you...
But that's it. You trust him with your life. Yeah. You know, like, everything with Phil, you knew you were safe. Yeah. That's what one thing we all agreed in the gym. You know, we always knew that we were safe. Phil was a reassuring person in the corner that you need, any fighter needs. You know, if you got him in the corner, all we knew when we turned up to the gym, I knew especially, that all I had to do is listen to him and train, and you know that you're winning the fight. You know it. You know what I mean? It's like an unbelievable feeling what you got. You're not even bothered who he is in the corner. You know you're going to win the fight.
So when I think of your pro career, I think it in two parts. I think with Phil, without Phil. Mm. With Phil, British champion, undefeated. Yeah. And then when Phil went, it obviously broke your heart. And I look at the fights you had after Phil, and that's when you got your losses. But their fights, you're preparing for your fight. You've got someone in your corner you're not quite familiar with. I mean, it's a challenge for any fighter, and to be fighting with a broken heart like you was. Mm. I almost feel that when your sort of career came to an end, it was almost, you probably won't agree, but almost a relief, because you knew that the career was going to be over when Phil passed away. Mm. You're like, I can't do this without Phil. And then you carried on because that's all you knew. And then your career at the end, when it comes to the end, it's almost like, well, it's over now.
Yeah, that was it. When Phil was dying and passing on, we were here in the gym, and Phil wasn't around a lot because he was trying to start with, you know, the cancer.
Yeah.
And so we were here anyway, and he kept coming in every now and again, and everyone else was getting on with their, you know, I mean, the boxing training, but it was missing for me. It was deep in there, it was missing. And I kept thinking to myself, what am I going to do? And so, we went to, Phil came in, and I kept going down to the house. Me, Joe Gallagher, you know, a few of us, kept going to the house and seeing Phil, looking for him. And then Phil, you could see Phil losing weight and being ill and everything else. And he was like, you know, I kept thinking. And I remember saying to the guys, I said, are you guys worried about your career? Are you not worried about it? And they all kept saying to me, no, well, I'm not worried about it. And I kept thinking, how come I'm the only one that thinks like this? Because I know my boxing is over. I know that it's done, it's finished when Phil goes. I know some people can manage and carry on and get new trainers, and but I know this. Anyway, so Phil died, you know what I mean? Phil died, and we were there, and everyone came to the funeral. I mean, the funeral is upsetting. And I was just thinking, what now? That's all I kept thinking. So, I mean, I'm British champion still.
Yeah.
I'm British champion, you know, I'm undefeated. And I'm thinking, what now? And then I got this call of Ernie Fozzie at the time, I think he was, Danny Mancini was. And he said to me, right, Morris, you've got this fight, right, for, you know, European title, you know what I mean? And he started offering me all these figures, you know what I mean? And I've never dealt with anything like that. I've never even looked at it, because Phil's done everything. And so when that happened now, I was like, what do we do now? You know what I mean? And what do I say, and how do I manage this? And I didn't know nothing. I was just new to it. And so I remember I had no manager. I got nothing. And I'm British champion.
Yeah.
So I rang Frank Warren. I had a meet with him. I went over there to see him, and we sorted something out. He managed me. And then he said to me, he's going to bid. First of all, I told him about the offer that I've had from Danny Mancini, which was crap, you know what I mean? But me and Phil always decided before he died that we were going to go for the money. And I told the same thing to Frank Warren, and said, we're going for the dough. And good job we did, because I got paid quite a lot. And so he bid for the fight, and he called me up, and he said, Morris, we're fighting in France, we've got 100 and da 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 da. I was like, right, okay then. Okay then, Frank. I said, all right then. He goes, are you all right? I says, yeah, I'm all right. I'll think about it then. When I got up to the phone, I was like, yes. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So, and that's what happened there.
So after Phil passed, you kind of packed your bags and you went to London, and you're kind of staying in hotels and kind of going from gym to gym, sparring different people, but you didn't have a trainer. And then you bumped into Jimmy Tibbs. And Jimmy's quite fair with you.
Jimmy's a top guy. Jimmy, I got the sense of belief in him as soon as I met him, really, because I went to London, like I said, and I went to different gyms, and I was a champion, and I'm telling people, look, I'm fighting in about 5 weeks, you know what I mean? I need somewhere to train, need some manager, I need a trainer, I need everything. And so, and I'm still a champion, and I sparring with everybody, Terry Dunstan, all kind of guys in different gyms. And I thought, this ain't right, you know what I mean? Because I know what I need to win a fight, and I know what I need. This ain't training. I was just doing the best I could. I was on my own, living in hotels, King's Cross, you know, hotel to hotel room, just staying there because I didn't have nothing. And I just wanted to be, because I went to London away from everybody else, you know what I mean? I wanted to be away. Anyway, so I kept asking everyone, who's the best trainer? And everyone kept saying to me, Jimmy Tibbs. So I said, well, that's what I need then. So I went to see Jimmy in East London, in Peacock at the time. And I spoke to Jimmy. And then Jimmy said, yeah, I'll take it on. And so I said, right. But he knew that I was fighting. He knew what I was getting for the fight as well. And he turned around to me and said to me, you know what, Morris? He says, I've only known you for 2 weeks or whatever. He goes, for this fight, I'm going to take, and they're entitled to 10%. And he said, I'm going to take 5%. And I thought, well, at least I know he's not ripping me. Yeah. He's a main man. And the way me and Jimmy talked, and Jimmy was in...
Is that right? The light's gone off.
You burn out?
Is it tripped?
Hmm. It, Phil.
Yeah.
I've been here, Chris, I'm here, Jack. And I won't care if I seen Phil.
Yeah,
I'd be happy, man.
Yeah.
I've been sat here in the dark on my own like that, 3 o'clock in the morning.
And if you did,
and I'm going, I shut my eyes, I go, come on then, Phil, come on, show me, yeah, give me a sign, give me a sign, anything. Yeah. But he don't come like, don't wear like, does it?
So you obviously teamed up with Jimmy. He was obviously quite fair to you, but Jimmy had a bit of a he was in an impossible situation because you were kind of mourning the loss of Phil, and Phil was more than a trainer, he was a father figure. Mm. But Jimmy done the best he could with you, and you went over to fight Fabrice Tiozzo, who was a fantastic fighter. I mean, he went on to win titles at light heavyweight and cruiserweight world titles.
Yeah.
But to tell me the story when you was in your hotel room and you kept seeing him on the adverts.
So, I mean, I didn't know you knew that, Dan. So me and Jimmy are over there in France anyway. So everywhere I go, they're all going, you fighting? So I'm going, yeah, I'm going to mash up your boy, man, and all kind of things. And so I go in the change room. I go in my hotel room. So I said, let me put the TV on. He's French. I don't speak French. So I put the TV on, looking like this. And every single advert that came on was with him, Fabrice Tiozzo. And I thought, is this a video or something? You know, some recording. And every single advert that came on, it was him. And I thought, he can't be that famous, man. I don't know this boy. You know what I mean?
Yeah,
it was great to see, though, you know what I mean?
And then the handshake, so you kind of square off for the first time.
To the change room, me thinking I'm the big man. So I come there and I said, I'll show him my big man. So guys, he's been all this polite stuff, and we said we had to do a standoff thing. So I got his hand like that, so I squeezed his hand out. So nonsense, so I squeezed him like that. And he's gone like that to me, taking a piss, he's gone like that. Everyone's laughing at him, man. I'd say him, I was giving it all. Like I'm bad, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Jeez, didn't scrubble him in the towel, didn't work.
So then you get in the ring with him and he looks a different man than what he was at the weigh-in.
I can't believe it done. So I'm here now, right? I'm here. Imagine, I've got this crowd, right? This mad crowd, right? 30,000 or whatever there. And I'm there. And every single, you know, they're all cheering him. Yeah. Except this one. I can hear this one guy in the crowd going, come on, man. Like that, you know what I mean? The one person, you know, this crowd. So I looked for him, you know what I mean? And then I got in the ring and I looked. This guy come in the ring and he was just like someone else.
Yeah.
And I thought, he's big like this and he's looking at me like I've just done something to his mum or something like that. I was looking like this and I kept thinking, that's not my opponent. He don't look like that, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
He looked rough, boy, I tell you. And I was waiting for someone to say, that's not your opponent, you know, get him out, get the right opponent in there. And I said, this ain't the same guy in the press conference. And he's like, and he looked big and everything, you know what I mean? I thought, nah, this guy's different, man. And I'm still waiting. Even when I brought it to the center and they're saying, you know, give me the rules there and saying, you don't want no punches over here. That's, and I was looking and thinking, why don't someone come and get him out of here? That's not him. You know what I mean? This man just looking at me like this. You know what I mean? I thought, jeez, man. And even up to the bell rang, you know, I was still thinking that someone's going to say, this ain't him.
Yeah.
You know, but Jimmy's telling me what to do and I'm like, ding, ding, round one. I'm saying, that's not him. That's not him, boy. Anyway, yeah, and the rest is history, boy. But I'll tell you what, it's a tough fight, man. I got stopped on cuts in the fifth, I think it was. You know what I mean?
Was that a fight? It didn't matter who was training you. You didn't have Phil with you. You were never going to win it without Phil. Or is that unfair to say?
Well, you know, I done my best. Jimmy done his best as well with me.
Yeah.
But my mind wasn't there. You know, Jimmy's a top trainer, a top person, a top man. I'd have him in the corner anytime. You know, he was the best. And but Phil weren't there. It's hard for me to adjust another trainer. All I've had all my life from dot one is Phil.
Yeah.
You know, we never had anybody else. Phil took care of everything. Like I said from the beginning, as I say in the gym, all you have to do is turn up and do what Phil says. You know,
but also your mind wasn't there, was it? Because obviously you're still mourning Phil. You're going into a fight like that. You, the changing room is Phil's not there. He's not in the corner when you're in a bit of trouble.
Yeah, everything the same. Everything, like I said, everything. Phil wasn't there. It's nobody's fault. You know, it's life. Phil's died. It's nobody's fault that Phil's gone. But I couldn't deal with it.
Yeah.
Jimmy done the best. Not taking nothing at all away from Jimmy. Jimmy's a top guy. Me and him had some great talks. Even out there, he was talking to me all the time and reassuring me about certain things. You know, I'd have him anytime.
Yeah.
But it's because I had the loss of Phil not being there. And because if Phil was there, I knew things might have been, but more than likely would have been different.
So there was the world title opportunity that never happened. Was that before or after Fabrice Tiozzo?
That was after.
So
because I had another fight with them in Belgium after that, and I stopped him, this tough head boy there, boy. I tell you, I never hit someone so hard in my life, right? And this boy was just standing there, like, demoralizing. I was hitting him clean with my knuckle, clean down. And he was just like, and he got stopped in the sixth round, I think he was. You know what I mean? I was so happy that I got stopped. I couldn't believe it, this guy.
Yeah.
Just kept taking knuckle after knuckle. And then I had another fight in, and my teammate Cal.
We'll get onto him afterwards.
Yeah, I got another fight there on his show when he fought Ralph Rocciani at the GMX. And I fought an American guy there and stopped him in two. Yeah. And then I got this fight to go to fight, what's his name?
You said it before.
This is boxing for you, innit?
I know, it's a couple of punch drunk guys.
Yeah. I was supposed to fight him and like I said, I'd done all my training, done everything with Jimmy. Everything went great. You know, I'd done all my sparring, finished everything, got my weight down, done the press conferences down here. And I'm flying to Germany on that day to fight for the world title, WBO. And what do you call it? I got there and I'm like sniveling now. And I was like coughing and Jimmy's like, you know, I said, I don't know. And next thing, flipping it, it's got worse and I couldn't do nothing at all. And Jimmy said, we can't go. You can't go, you got a flu, you can't go. You know what I mean? And that was that. So that's fucking got relinquished, man.
And then the last fight, obviously missed out on that opportunity.
Darius Michinchesky.
Oh yeah.
That's his name. Well,
so then the last fight, Mark Prince, and that's when it was sort of finally over for you, you sort of realised.
Yeah.
Mark Prince, good fighter, strong?
I thought he was okay fighter, you know. You know, I know my capabilities, you see, and I know what I'm capable of. Like I said, I'm still got the... I'm not altogether there, you know what I mean? I knew... A bit selfish of me, really, with Jimmy, but I knew that I wasn't me. You know, I knew that I wasn't 100%. I knew that I wasn't... Not taking nothing away from Mark Prince. He'd done his job. And well done to him. You know what I mean? He done what he had to do. You know what I mean? So not taking nothing. I like him, but I know him better than what I know him better than that. And I remember going into the fight, and they kept, you know, I had some press coming up to me saying to me, "Matt Prince is going to knock you out," and I says, "You know, I'm not going to knock him out." And I wasn't even bothered about it. You know, I wasn't bothered at all about it. I was just saying it because that's what they expected me to say.
Yeah.
And you know, he come in there to do his job, and he got his job done. And I don't take nothing away from that. You know, but that wasn't me fighting.
Yeah.
Not being disrespectful to Mark. It wasn't me fighting there. You know, I know I'm better than that. You know, whether he would have done that to me if it was around is another story. But, you know, he done his job. He beat me fair and square. And
Like I said, I look at your pro career in two parts, before and after Phil. After that Mark Prince fight, you call it a day. Was you ever tempted to come back?
Well, I came back to Manchester then.
Yeah.
I came back to Manchester and... you know, after a while, because he wasn't playing sailing in London. I didn't like the way I realised about the management side of it, and I didn't like the way it was run. And I just realised then how Phil managed everything with us, and he had all the headaches, plus trying to live his own personal life. And he had, 20 guys, you know what I mean? So, and I was talking about myself. So I realised then that he's not for me. And the hard part about this was saying to people like you've retired, you know, and I didn't realize, and I just use that, because people usually come up to you and say, when you're fighting, and you say, oh, yeah, I'm fighting, you know, that kind of stuff, and that's your life.
Yeah.
But once you retire, you made your mind up with that. The hard part is to say that I've retired, and once you say it, it's not too bad, you know what I mean, and you have to work on something else, what you can do then. Mine wasn't bad at all, because, you know, I had that lingering in me. I knew that I retired in my head, but I didn't tell people that. And then one day I said, I retired, and it's hard to say, but I said it, and when I did, it was easy. And then it was good, because people got that message, and then I started getting the other side of my life then, the training side.
Well, what I was going to say is, the rumour, right, I heard you might have been fighting Tommy Ernst, just talk of that, when he come to Manchester.
Tommy Ernst?
Yeah.
Not me.
No, I can't remember where he heard that he come over. He was going to have a bit of an exhibition and that. But talk of exhibitions, what
Holyfield.
About... Holyfield?
Holyfield. So what happened was, I was champion at the time, and Holyfield was coming over here.
Yeah, yeah.
To fight. He was fighting on... Do you remember when... what's his name? What's his name? Came over here. He was training with Phil. The Australian, Barry Michaels.
Yeah.
Yeah, he came over here, Phil, and he was fighting in Windsor Castle against, now you're testing it. Anyway, Holyfield was coming over.
Yeah.
And he's looking for an opponent, so my name got mentioned up for that. But I'm glad he said no.
Yeah,
I bet. Because he went up to cruiserweight. Sorry. Yeah, he went up to cruiserweight, and he wanted a cruiserweight. And that was that.
So... am I right in thinking as well, Phil sorted you an exhibition out? He said, don't knock the guy out.
Early on in the career, yeah.
Yeah.
So he said, the first fight, he said, it's right, it's an exhibition fight, Morris. So he said, you can't knock him out, and he ain't going to knock you out. But you know, them things never work out. No. You know what I mean? You know, so I just said, no problem. And then the referee said, call the assistant, and he says, don't knock each other out. No, I said, so we're just like that. Yeah. The next thing you know, we start bam, bam, bam. He hits you a bit hard. You hit him a bit harder. He hits you harder. He hits him harder. Yeah. Referee stops you. You know, calm it down. No problem. And he just can't help it. Reaction, buff, left hook.
Yeah.
And he went down. Referee's looking at him like this. He's going, what'd I tell you? He's counting the kid, and the kids go up, and then the kid's like, come on then. You know what I mean? Yeah. So he just gets out of hand. You know what I mean? Anyone would say that at boxes. You know, you can't help yourself.
It's like the sparring when someone says, should have a nice, easy spar, just have a move around.
That's correct. So that's what happened.
Never happens, does it? Yeah. How do you sort of assess your career? Are you satisfied with your achievements? Or is it that bit lingering in your mind that thinks, well, if Phil was about, I might have did this, I might have done that. Are you quite content?
At first, you know sometimes the way you drift off as well and think, what could you have achieved? You know, and but it comes out of your mind.
Yeah.
It does come out of your mind quick. Because you can drift on and think what you could have if Phil was still around. Who knows? If Phil was still alive, you know, where would we all be? But I had some great times, you know, after Phil's passed. And you know, I can't really I wouldn't have had that if Phil was still around.
Well, your career comes to an end, and obviously you're British champion, and you had all the kind of things that went with that. But then you kind of got involved with Nazim Hamid. How did that come about? How did you and Prince Nazim become friends?
Well, if I remember right, like, he used to come to my press conferences. Okay. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
I used to see him in the background. We got talking because he was always a character, wasn't he?
Yeah.
And so we got talking, and we just gelled. And then one day, I went in the change room to see him when he's fighting in Sheffield, and he's just completely different than what I was used to. And I was retired then, and so I hung around more and more. And then he was coming to an end with his career with Brendan Ingle.
Yeah.
And I used to go down to see him. He used to come down see me over here in Manchester because he's fighting a lot over here.
Yeah.
And then one day he said to me, he liked the training, what Phil done.
Yeah.
So I respected that, what he said. He always looked out to Phil. And he said to me, we want to come down to his next training camp and do some conditioning stuff. And I says, cool. You know what I mean? So I did. And that's what happened. So I think we went to, where did we go?
Tenerife,
yeah. Went Tenerife training there. Mount Tidy, yeah?
Yeah.
That was good. So obviously you get to know someone a lot better then. And then we just kicked it off from there.
So what was he like away from the cameras? Because we all know Naz to be confident, flashy and all the rest of it. Was he a different person? Was he a bit deeper when the cameras weren't on him?
Yeah, a whole lot deeper. You know, when you have him on a one-on-one, you know, he'll talk some deep stuff to you. He starts to talk a lot about his culture, you know, and stuff like that, which is cool. It's not a problem with me. And they try and put that on you, you know what I mean? But it's not bad. It's not bad what he's telling you. He's just telling you what he believes in. And he talks to you about other stuff, you know what I mean? But on the camera, obviously, you're seeing what he sees and everyone thinks what they think. But he's a deep person. He's a good person as well, you know?
Yeah.
You know, he can be loud and he can be vicious as well in certain circles. But, you know, I've been around him one-on-one and I've been around him in camp many a times. And I've been around him when his mum and dad unfortunately passed away. But when his mum and dad were alive and I watched what went on, and I used to watch him and think, guys, this is a respectful person. And his mum and dad used to come there and no matter what's going on in gym, no matter what's going on in training, no matter what's going on, he stopped the whole thing. Yeah. Everyone has to come out and he'd be with the mum and dad. No matter what's going on, he'd be with them for 2 days talking.
Yeah.
And you wouldn't see him at all. He'd be locked up in a room with them both.
I remember that. I remember talking to you about and the respect he had for his mum and dad. Was
he just respects, right? Just everything for the mum and dad. Everything for the mum and dad.
Yeah. So your time with Naz, you had some obviously great times.
Yeah.
Tell me about the time you get a phone call, you're in Witherton, you get the phone call, Naz is going to come and pick you up. And
helicopter.
He lands a helicopter. Did he land it on Hough End, I think?
Boy, I'd say Naz is there. So we're down there, so Naz says, where are you? So I says, not my house. He says, are you feeling near you? So I says, yeah. So I told him where it was, man. He must have told the helicopter boy there. He says, I'm going to Liverpool, I'm going to pick you up. Can you be there in about 1 hour? So I said, of course, man, I'll be there. I didn't think he'd come. I thought he'd be driving.
Yeah.
And I just say this thing. You know what I mean? He's like, come on, quick. You know what I mean? We've gone straight buff to Liverpool, you know.
Yeah.
And I thought, only he could do that, you know what I mean? I know we're getting done for that.
Yeah.
In police station right there as well, you know what I mean?
And from that point, is that the time when you didn't really go on for 6 weeks? It was just kind of bum, bum, bum.
Oh, that was stupidness, man. That was some crazy time there, boy, because... So I'm in there, we're in there, Naz, and then we're in his house in Sheffield. He gets a phone call to see Puff Daddy. So he said to me, Morris, come down to London. We're going to see Puff Daddy. I said, listen, man, I've got these flip-flops on, right? I got this short sleeve shirt on here. You know what I mean? It's summer, you know what I mean? I said, listen, I ain't going anywhere to see Puff Daddy. He goes, come on, Morris, man, you're back in a bit, you know what I mean? So I says, all right then, so we got in his Bentley, straight down there, straight to London. Went to the Met Hotel in Park Lane down there. And we got down there, walk inside. So it's not really dawned on me that he's Puff Daddy, you know what I mean? Just, I know they're going to see him, but it's not really dawned on me. So We park up, we go upstairs, and he says, he calls him and he says, I'm going to send my boy down. So he sends this guy down called Tex, some big, never seen a big guy in my life. And the guys look like this. He made me look like Nazi size, you know what I mean? Big guy coming to the stairs like this, come out the lift. And he went, Naz, come in, man. So we stood up next to him and I'm looking at him like this in the lift. So we get out of the lift and we go in this big room where he's in. And then Puff Daddy's, his barber's there. He's got these couple of girls there and his brother's there as well, you know what I mean? And then we're waiting around for Puff Daddy. And the next thing you know is this Puff Daddy comes out, man. And that's when it hit me then. I thought, geez, man, Puff Daddy, man. He's got this shiny suit on. He's got the blinged up here, blinged up rings, everything, you know what I mean? I'm like, boy, boy, I can't believe this. So we get up and we're shaking hands and he's like, yeah. He goes, look here, man, look here. He goes, where are we going? So we go, next thing, we're going out to a club, Club de Paris we're going. So Naz is arguing with him about which Bentley to take. I got mine. He's going, listen, man, I got my shit outside. And he's got all these girls with him as well, you know, because they're promoting his new album, Forever. That's how long ago it was, the album. So he's got all the van labels on the side of these vans, and there must be about eight of them. Fills them all up with these guys and the girls, and then we go in his car, and next thing we get to Club de Paris, there's all cameras out there, you know what I mean? Everyone going in, like, I still got these flip-flops on, you know what I mean? So I'm walking around the place. So I'm thinking, Jesus, man, he could have flipping done something, you know what I mean? So they're all blinged up and everything else, you know what I mean? So we're in there, and then Puff Daddy's stamping on the table like this, and the pie's going, he's going, drinks for everybody, and they're saying the club's closed, and they're saying, no, he's drinks for everybody, opens it back up. The next thing, we all go back to his place, the hotel. And so we're all in the hotel and all the supermodels are in there, all the guys, all the girls, and the partying going on. And Puff Daddy's got this big system in there, man. And he goes, Naz, come here. I'm following him. He goes, you see, when I go anywhere, I bring my shit with me. And I tell you, he's just got all these reel-to-reel backs, all his hi-fi equipment, all on one wall. And then this guy comes with long hair and he goes, pump it up like that. And he's got boop, boop, boop. He puts it on, think you know it's going to be loud when he goes, when he puts it on, he goes, boom, yeah, that long bass thing.
Yeah.
And next thing you know, the music starts, boom, boom, boom. This is like 4 o'clock in the morning, you know, in the middle of the Park Lane Hotel there. And he's on the hotel, he's going, my Puff Daddy's on the bed like this, man. And the music's banging through everybody, boy. And everyone's like, jeez, man. Anyway, so next thing you know, the police come and all the women are dancing on the bed and everything. It's mad, mad, crazy times. The police come, clipboard, what's your name? You have to get out, you're not here. So me and Naz went next door, stayed there. And then we got up in the morning, and then Naz says, Morris, this is what it's like. He goes, I've got to go to New York. So I said, when? He goes, tomorrow. So I says, but just drop me off, man. He goes, nah, I want you to come, man, you and Clifton. So I says, you what? I said, look here, man, I got nothing on. I still got a flip-flops on from last night. He goes, nah, you come in, man. I said, don't worry, where's your passport? So the next thing, he gets the flipping car to bring the passports down. And next thing, we're going to some party that same night as well. He's wild. Went to some party that night in some place. I don't know where Naz got his flipping address from. So we go out there, we come back. Next day, we're going shopping, buying all underwear and everything. And
yeah.
Clothes and all that business and coats. Next thing, we're on a flight to New York. So we go in New York. Remember when Naz done the advert?
The King, Kevin, and all that.
He's doing all that thing there. So they're promoting him, and HBO spent over $1 million on him, promoting him all over America. And so we're doing all that. We're in a hotel. And that same week, Tyson comes out. So Tyson's in our hotel, apparently. So it's dead weird because we didn't know Mike Tyson there. We're like going to the front desk, excuse me, can I get Mike Tyson's room, please? You know what I mean? And then I got like, no one by Tyson staying here. No one, but he's in the hotel, you know what I mean? So we're there anyway. We up and down the place, all these different HBO channels, all these music channels. Naz is going everywhere and Naz is in everyone's face. And the next thing now, we went back to the hotel one night and Tyson's there. Like, yes, boy, you know what I mean? You couldn't get near the boy, but he wanted Naz, you know what I mean? He said, come here, come here. And Tyson got his girl over his shoulder there. You know what I mean? Turned Muslim, you know, and he's got, oh, he's funny, boy. So we're just like this kind of thing. And then next thing, we, you know, next day, seeing him there as well, what's it called? Him out of Lethal Weapon.
Oh, my goodness.
What's his name? Not Mel Gibson, his partner.
I don't know.
Anyway, he was there, the cool guy as well. So next day, Naz says, you know what? I'm fed up of this, man. I'll go somewhere warmer. Let's go California. So he has to buy some more clothes, you know what I mean? So next thing, now we're on a plane. We're going to California. So next thing, now we go to the airport. And we go in the airport, and Denzel Washington's in the airport. I'm like, Jesus, man. And I'm not starstruck at all, but Denzel Washington's a boy, man. Yeah. So we come in there, and Denzel's there, and he goes, and he's like that, hey, Naz, just reading about you in the paper now. So we go over there talking to him, and I'm like, jeez, man. I mean, I don't take a picture of nobody but him, I had to. So then we go over there, and he's cool with us, man, proper cool with us. And we talk him, we get on a plane with him, and then we get to Cali now, right? So we're going to, we go to this hotel, we get looked after, we get someone picks us up, driver. And this hotel right at the side, it's like flipping Hilton. And all Naz's pictures are at the side of the hotels, you know, it's massive. And, you know, Naz, he must have been really proud, because he's like going, look at me, man. A guy from Winker Bank, and look at all this. Look at all this there for me. And so, you know, we're there partying up, doing all the things that you do back in the day. And went somewhere else. Next morning, Michael Jackson's bodyguard turns up and he's like, Naz, Michael wants to see you. And I was saying to them, you know, listen, you go, because I want my sleep. You lot go, man. I need to sleep, man. I've been out all night.
But only you, Morris, man, could turn down going to Neverland for
that's
sleep,
what I'm saying.
Man.
So I'm glad they never. Anyway, so in the end, we all went, took us to coffee, took us to McDonald's, got a coffee, then we just drove there, boy. Jeez, man. So we just drive to Neverlands through all this land. And we got there and we got in Michael Jackson's house and we sat there like this and we're knackered, right? But you see Michael Jackson's pictures all over the walls. He's got some beautiful pictures of his family in it. And we're there, we just sat there. And again, I didn't believe that was there until he came downstairs.
Yeah.
And he come downstairs, Michael Jackson. And I was like, Jesus, it's Michael Jackson, boy. You know what I mean? So we got up and we're shaking hands. I got a load of pictures there. And he's a cool guy, man. He's a, you know, I know a lot of things were going on. I said, can I take some pictures? And he said, yeah, but he said, don't take none of the kids. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So I said, no, but I did take some of the kids. You know, you always do what you're not supposed to do. And he was cool with us. He said, listen, he's like a big kid. And he says, come on, get in the car. So we all get in the car. He has like little, you know, little golf buggies.
Yeah.
He has like loads of them. So we all get in one each. He's like, follow him. So he followed him. He's got a big dance studio there. He went to his dance studio and he's coming there and he goes, right. He goes, Naz, here's what I want you to do in your next fight. Come on like this. And he busts his move, right? Dan, he busts his move, right? And we were like, huh? You know what I mean? He's like, I don't know. I've never seen anybody bend a body like him. And it's this boy's the best performer I've seen in my life, you know?
Yeah.
And I said, we were like, do that again. He's like, do it again. And he's like doing it over and over. And he said, Naz, do it like this. And Naz is trying it, but it weren't working at all. Yeah. Don't ask me to try it, because there's no way I could even think about doing it. And then he took us on his train. He's got a big train that went all around Netherlands, and he took us all around there. And then he took us to his, he's got a lion there. He's got a big, massive lion. Never been so close to a lion in my life. And this lion was in a cage that was in another cage. And it was in another cage. And this, we walk into this lion, right? Just walking like we're cool. And this lion, have you heard a lion growl?
Yeah.
Have you been up live one?
Yeah, I'm jammed.
Jeez, man, this lion growl, it's like bass coming through the ground.
Yeah.
And I just went, that boy, that's cool enough for me. I'm not going nowhere near him, man. So I said, yeah, see you later. And then yeah, we've done that. And then, boy, and then this is in the space like 5 weeks.
Yeah.
So then Michael Jackson was there, he come, watched us training, we went back to Puff Daddy's, you know what I mean? And we just had a good time and he went to the office in New York then. Yeah. Then we got another flight and then Naz had to do something for MTV. and then we had to go to Holland, and then we flew to Holland, and then we're flipping it. We're just with some guys out there, having a great time, and flew back to London. This is 6 weeks, and I still got my flip-flops on. You know,
you probably mean? Still got them.
They're flip-flops, man. I'm flipping khaki trousers. I couldn't believe it. You know what I mean? But that was you know, that was an experience and a half. That, you know, we've done that. And that's just one of the experiences.
So how do you go from, like, so you have a 6 weeks like that, how do you go then to just sit in your home and you're just like, right, I'm back to reality now? I mean, that must be quite a come down.
Yeah, this reality for you, you have to get real. You have to get real with things. And so yeah. I got real with things quite quick because I realized that it's and I think it filled really that, you know, installed that in me real quick, because I realized that it's not me. It's not me because people want you, but you only want you because you're with him.
Yeah.
So people will say, come here, and can I do this and do what you want? You know, but when you get back, you know, when I got back, there's a big pile of bills waiting for me on the floor. You know what I mean? So, you know, everything's there, everyone's paying and you're living and you're walking in the street and yeah, a couple of people know you, but that's about it. But when Naz, he lives that life, that's his life, that's how he lives. And it's all him, it's not you. And you have to stay grounded with it all, you know, because you really think that it's you then. You know
well,
what I mean?
I was going to say, for someone like Naz, is it impossible to stay grounded? Was that the role of his family? I know he's close to his parents and his family. Was it their job and maybe the job of his friends around him to keep him grounded? Or yeah, is it just impossible to do?
Well, that's what I'm saying, because he has to live this persona, what he gives out. Yeah. And he lives that. That's every day he has to do that. You know, up to now, he's still doing it. He has to live his persona and people will treat him that way.
Yeah.
Whereas us, we just got to keep it grounded because we're not him, you know. Yeah. We're not him, and we're not living the life where he's living. He's living that even when we leave him, he's still living that life.
Yeah,
we're not. We're just back to our 9 to 5, you know what I mean? And we're doing what we have to do to survive, you know what I mean? So, you know, when you get back with him, he can get back on it.
Yeah.
But he realized that everybody, it's just life and people, how they are. You realize you get a lot of experience with it. You know, I went to. I've been everywhere with Naz. I've been all over the world with that guy. I've been to training camp in Philadelphia. You know, I've been to Poconos, Lennox Lewis's place where he trains. You know, we've been New York. We've been Chicago. We've been, you know,
MTV all over. Music Awards.
Yeah, so we've been all over the place. You know, and I've been to Yemen. I've been to Jordan with him. You know, all different places. You know,
what was it like going to Yemen with him? His home country.
Yeah, Yemen. He's like a superstar out there, and because they look at it like he put Yemen on the map, so they were kind of like when I got there, when I first got there, it was like royalty, and no shot of that. You know, and he said to me, "You're going to be surprised when you get here," and you know, we got off the plane and you know, security. We were first to the plane, like, come here. So go in that room there. And we went in that room there, and then someone just asked for your passport, give him the passport, and don't worry about nothing. Sit down, have a cup of coffee here. Do you want a drink? And I like, and everyone else was coming this way, and they go, you look that way. You know what I mean? So we got separate. And then when we got out there, straight out of there, was in Cherokees, you know, American.
Mm.
Four of them, all lights like this flashing. Everyone's standing in crowds waiting.
Yeah.
And they're like, ooh, all the women are like this waiting for Naz to come out. And we all get in the car and they're all like, Naz. It's crazy. And then it's sirens all the way to, you know, blue light all the way to the hotel. You know, pure royalty it was, you know what I mean? That's all it was. Treat him like good. And then he went to see the Prime Minister of Yemen and went there, and it was different out there, you know. I mean, I don't understand the Muslim Arabic ways, whatever. I don't understand Arabic speaking. So it was different for me. So when I got there now, and Naz is down there and I'm up here and I'm talking to Naz and security guys coming up to me like this. I see him pointing at me like that, you know, to shut me up. And come up and I said, listen, I'm all right. You know, I'm like this. But it's all different for me, you know what I mean? And Naz knew what's going on. Whoops. Yeah, Naz knew what was going on, and it's completely different. When Naz went there, he got in this room, opened the door, and just, I was with Clifton Mitchell.
Yeah.
No, Clifton.
Yeah, yeah.
So me and Clifton went everywhere with Naz, and so in this room, we give Naz his Rolex, boy, and we're like, me and Clifton are like. And he just forgot all about us. He's just pure Naz, that's all he is. He's Naz. So yeah, we had a great time with Naz. Like, so, I went to Malaysia with Naz as well once as well. I've been to proper, been all over the world with that boy.
All first Surprise. Class. Surprise.
Yeah, all first class. Yeah.
What a life. Mm. So with Naz, when it was time to work, when it was training camp, did he switch off from that and get down to work?
He works hard. He works hard. Yeah. You know, he works hard and he, you know, because he's dieting and it's easy. It's easy to, you know, it's like my Vinagla say, it's hard to get up when you got silk pajamas on.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? But, you know, it's he did get up and he trained and sometimes he just be flipping and do something, buff like anything. Where's he getting energy from? But when he could punch him.
Yeah.
Don't get me wrong about that. I tell you, that guy could punch, you know. I had never seen a featherweight punch like him. And it's not because I'm with him and I'm creeping or anything like that. That guy's one of the hardest punches I've ever seen, you know, considering his weight. He could bang. Sometimes you have to look and say, do that again. You know what I mean? Because he could punch.
Did you ever feel it? I remember watching a video of Clifton sparring him. I don't know if you ever, like, body sparring, but whether you ever body sparred him or had him on the pads or anything.
No.
I had him on the pads.
And even when he put on the weight, and he was putting, mind you, he's supposed to punch, he put on the weight. But he could punch, boy. He could really punch and his speed with it as well. He could see how he knocked people out, you know what I mean? You could see how he does that.
I love Naz, one of my favourite fighters. But what made the difference with him? So in your career, Morris, you've been about boxing a long time. You've been multiple champions and all the rest of it. What made the difference with Naz? Was it his mindset? Was it he was just like, I don't know, there's just something about him. I can't describe it. Maybe you can.
Yeah, he was just heavily talented, wasn't he? You know, he was talented and confident. Yeah, the unbelievable confidence about him.
Yeah.
He didn't care who he was. And, you know, you check out any boxing champion, you know, that level, there's always something wrong with him. There's not one sound guy. There's got to be something wrong with you. Yeah. And you have to be eccentric to an extent to be a champion.
Yeah.
And that's not in a bad way I say that, you know. You have to be something wrong with you. You have to be something wrong with you. You know, it's a mad sport anyway. You want to get punched in the jawbone every day, you know, to be a champion. And I believe that as well.
So what was he like when he's sparring much and he spars? Was he a good sparrer? Did he not spar much? What was it like?
Sometimes, you know, what I knew about him, a champion, when Naz sparring, if he had a bad spar, he would always look to correct it and he'd take it real personal. You know, if you had a bad spar, he'd take it personal. And I remember him saying a few occasions, watch what happens tomorrow. And he made sure that person paid the next day. Yeah. And he's a killer with it because he was cold. You know, when we thought he had enough of a person, he'd still be looking to do inflict damage on him. Yeah. You know what I mean? And so you know that. That's a champion. That's what I'm saying about something wrong with you.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? These champions, they want to do serious damage. You know, if your grandma's in the corner, they kill her. You know what I mean? They would kill her, man. You know what I mean? She's in that ring in the corner. And that's the difference between a champion and not a champion.
Well, one of my favourite Naz fights is obviously the Kevin Kelly fight, full of drama. Yeah. What was it like watching that live?
I tell you, it's teeth biting anyway. You know, nail biting, I should say. You know, because the first time I seen Naz go down, any kind of trouble like that, you know, and he seemed to be catching him easy, Kevin Kelly. And I sat with the family and I was thinking, geez, and they were all screaming anyway.
Yeah.
But what, I mean, that fight there is what made Naz.
Yeah.
That's what made him in America, that fight. Because it was, you know, that's the fight where we went down there advertising for, and he was up and down the fight. He didn't know what was going on.
Yeah.
And everyone didn't know who Naz was, but they definitely knew who he was after that fight.
Champion always finds a way, don't
he? He couldn't have gone any better for him that fight, up and down. Because if Naz went out there just knocked him out, he'd have to prove it again and again and again. But because he was up and down and bang, 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 you know, no one didn't know what was going to go on.
For you, what was his best performance? I remember you talk about he was training in Detroit and he trained proper out there. He had a great training camp. What fight was that for? Do you remember?
That was for, he was fighting, what's he called, in London. Manny Bongo.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
Yeah, he's fighting him, but we was in Detroit doing all that. But I'll tell you what, he was right for that fight because he went, he's right about that. Great training camp. We went to the Crunk, you know what I mean, in Detroit. That's a gym and a half.
That what was that like? I've obviously heard the stories. Is it in a basement?
Yeah, that gym there, you go in. It's a rough area, which you'd imagine.
Yeah.
And you go in and you go down the stairs and down the stairs, the boxing, the basketball court, you go down again, you go right to the very bottom, and that's the Crunk. And when you go there, it's like the more Rocky films, you know where to go in there. It's just people, all Padman and all trainers, about four or five trainers in there, and all shouting, come on, and that kind of thing. And it's proper in there, you know, you can smell it, it stinks. It's all underwater as well, because it's at the basement. So the change room's underwater, you know, it's flooded a little bit, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
And they had this like pipe room in the corner.
Yeah.
A lot of guys would have been good to see that gym because they need to know. And they had a pipe room in the corner. Look how many world champions Manny had, Emmanuel Stewart. And they had this pipe room in the corner. And if you become a champion in that gym, you can get changed in there. And just boiling pipes, it was 100 degrees in there.
Yeah.
That's why they were making weight. It was roasting. All the main pipes were there for the building. It was roasting. But when there was sparring session on, everybody stopped to watch the sparring. And it's, come on, come on.
Yeah.
No sitting down. So it's great. Great atmosphere in there.
It was known for hard sparring. Is that what it's like when you're in there? You see some tough sparring.
Yeah, yeah. And when Naz turned up in there, they all knew who he was and that. And they all, you know, Naz on the pads. They're all watching. But they're all full of praise for Naz, you know.
Yeah.
Naz fit right in there. But that's the best train I've seen him.
Yeah. Said,
well, me in my eyes, he probably trained before that. I didn't see, but what I did see, that's the best part.
So, for you, when you were involved, in what was his best performance? Would you say when was it his best?
I say that could be one of them there.
Yeah,
that one there, and it was. What's he called? What's his name? He had 25 fights and knocked most of them out as well. A kid in...
Not like Augie Sanchez.
Augie Sanchez as well, you know what I mean? He fought him. Yeah, Indian Wells.
Yeah.
Was out there for a long time. Was in Pennsylvania training for that.
Yeah.
He went to Pennsylvania training with Lennox Lewis in his training camp.
What was it like watching Lennox go about his business? Very professional.
Yeah, well, we got there. We don't really know much about camps because I started doing the camps late.
Yeah.
So we got there. So Lennox is like, yeah, Naz, this is going to be great. You and me, we're going to be running and we're going to be doing this. So Naz is like, yeah. So Lennox goes, listen, Naz, I'm going to come for you. I'll be there at 6 o'clock in the morning. I'll be there. You make sure I'll come in. So we're like, Naz is like, because Naz is not a runner. So Naz is like, no, Lennox, man, I'm all right. I'll just do my, you know what I mean? You do your trick, I'll do mine. And he's going, no, man, I'm going to be there. Make sure I'll be there. So then 6 o'clock in the morning comes and, geez, man, boof, 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 on the door. So we're like, dark, you know, we're like this, you know what I mean? Boof, boof, boof. Yes, come on. Open the window. Lennox there, he's like, wow, man, Lennox, about 5 guys there on the running gear. Come on, let's go. So, so Nazi's that big compared to Lennox's up there, you know what I mean? And you're running, Nazi's like 10 steps to Lennox's one. It's funny, but I tell you, Naz didn't want that at all, you know what I mean? Because Naz ain't really the runner type.
Yeah.
But he did get into the running, though. I made him get into the running as well, you know, we started doing a lot of hill stuff.
Yeah.
But I could run then. And I got Lennox's guy. Lennox had a runner. This guy came down, probably a waste of time. The guy came down with all the latest gear on, all that business, had all the watches, all the timers, all the heartbeat monitors, everything, you know what I mean? And he come down there, he's like, yeah. So I said to him, do you fancy a run? And he says, yeah, why not? Come on, let's go. So we went running. So I said, where are we going to go? He goes, you want to do the same route as last time? So I says, yeah. So he's running and the pace was slow, boy.
Yeah.
The pace was slow, man. I said, this can't be it. He's setting me up here. You know what I mean? So I carried on running again. So I speeded up a little bit. And I seen him dropping behind, lagging.
Yeah.
So I said, are we going the same route where we went last time? And he went, yeah. Go on, carry on.
Yeah.
And I run down a run, and for about another 4 miles. And I went down the wrong road. and I had to turn around. I done like a mile extra. And I come back, and he still weren't there. He still weren't caught up. But yeah, that was a good old day.
You were a good runner, weren't you? I remember running in the morning and there was a few of us running and we bumped into you and we just started our run and you were like, this was years and years ago, and you were like, come on, you're coming for a run. And we were like, and someone in our team was like, no, we're just finishing our run. And then you went off and I went, why did you say that? He said, you don't want to run with Morris, man. Yeah. It's a tough old run.
Yeah, it's good old running, man. That's what I mean. Because Phil took me to St. Hilaire's.
Yeah.
And I kept saying to Phil, you got me here for, I'm not a runner, I'm a boxer. Yeah. And he goes, going to test you in here, you know what I mean? But, you know, don't matter anyway. Good old days.
Tell me about your time in Big Bear. Did you enjoy it, first of all? But also, the time you went walking and you heard there's bears about, so you brought yourself a little knife.
A little knife. Big knife, man. I tell you, so we're walking in Big Bear. It's Big Bear, right?
Yeah.
So Oscar De La Hoya's place, we're staying at his place in there. So Big Bear, I know about Big Bear. It's like 7,000-8,000 foot altitude. It's a ski resort, really. We were there in the summer training, so there's nobody there, and the ski resort is full. We were running, and it bumped into Mayweather there as well, you know.
I was gonna ask about that. Yeah, go on.
Okay, so we were up in the mountain there, so we went walking one night. So we just knew that there were bears there. We'd never seen one, but we just knew there were bears. So we bought ourselves a big Rambo knife like this, big, massive knife. So we're walking with the knife like this, feeling good. And then we're seeing the police came. So we got this knife out, you know what I mean? We're hidden. So we're just walking with this knife like this. So the cop has seen us, he's reversed like that. He goes, where you going with that, son? So he says, we're going for walking. He goes, what's that you got? He says, it's a knife for the bears. So the guy goes, that for the bears? He says, that ain't going to do shit to the bears. He says, bear going to claw your head off, man. He said, you think so? He said, and he just drove off, you know, left with his big knife. He's funny, boy. He said, that ain't going to do shit to the bears.
How was it being in Big Bear? Was it tougher, the altitude, when you're running up there? Did you notice it?
Yeah, it was, you know, Mount Tate is worse. That's 12. I think it was 7,000 feet. Yeah, that one.
It made me sick when I went up to Teide.
Say again?
It made me sick when I went up to the top of Mount Teide.
We've done that as well.
Yeah.
You went to the top over there. And you've been to the top?
Yeah. Where the cable cars take you right to the top.
Right. Well, you know, that's where they made Planet of the Apes.
No, I didn't know that.
That's where they made Planet of the Apes. So you're allowed to stay in a hotel up there, but you can only stay cyber 2 nights or 3 nights. Because after that, you start going dizzy for the altitude and... no air up there. You can't breathe.
Yeah. So life expectancy if the workers up there is a lot less.
Yeah, it's great. It's great, man. It's great training.
Yeah.
Because I remember going up there with training, doing sprints, and I thought I was fit and I was knackered.
Yeah.
And then I come back down here, went on a treadmill, and I could run forever.
Yeah.
Like, your lungs is massive, you know what I mean? Full of air, you know what I mean? So
what was it like, obviously, Naz teamed up with Oscar Suarez and then Emmanuel Stewart? What was it like spending time with Emmanuel Stewart?
Great. Experienced guy that, you know, Manny could look at a fight there and be with him. I used to talk to him all the time, and he'd be there, and he just recollecting a fight, and he'd say things like, you know, watch the next round, and he goes, what he needs to do is do da da da. He'd tell you whatever he needs to do, and then he'd say he needs to shoot that right hand through. Then he'd say he started doing it this round, and he just read the fight so different and clear.
Yeah,
and he just look at him thinking he'd read it different than you.
Yeah.
Where I would see it one way, he would see it. If he starts doing this, maybe he might win. Manny would tell you what he's going to do and what he's not going to do and what he will do. You know, he'd read it forward all the time. He'd know what the other person is doing, exactly what he's doing as well. Not just a guess. He'd say he's different, Manny, different guy.
So you've been around some great trainers, haven't you? Obviously, Phil Tibbs, Emmanuel Stewart, Oscar Suarez. You've been. So imagine when you went into training, you had a lot of kind of people to tap into, a lot of knowledge, or did you just go straight back to what Phil taught you?
Yeah, the training.
Yeah, so when you're training people.
The physical side was what Phil taught me, because one thing, the other thing in common, hard work, you know, so I knew what Phil was doing was the right thing to do.
I think Emmanuel Stewart said to you, didn't he, there's no substitute for hard work.
He always said that.
Yeah.
He always said that, there's no substitute. Hard work, man, you can't beat hard work, dedication, cannot beat it. No, because at the time, I think we're just coming in with these new machines for people.
Yeah.
People looking for corners to take, make it easier.
Yeah.
And you can't beat hard work. And that'll go for anybody.
So when you bumped into Mayweather, when you went for a run, didn't you? You bumped into Mayweather.
Big Bear.
Big Bear, yeah.
Yeah. So you're running. So we're running with Naz and a few guys, and he's running with his team, and then both like that. So a bit of a stare down the first, and Nas kind of talked to him. I said, listen, man, we were talking business. You know, they're saying, listen, man, we can make some money here, you know what I mean? And yeah. That's what he's talking. You're talking business. It's like a business deal going on. Yeah. And he said, listen, I'm going to talk to you. You're going to beef me this way, and I'll beef you that way, you know, kind of thing. And it was good to see how that went on, because I had never been on that level before. It's good to see how that was, you know, apparent that it could have happened.
What a great fight that would have been. They sparred as well, didn't they? Was there rumours that they sparred?
I didn't see the sparring.
You didn't see it, but it was.
If they did, yeah. I'm not sure.
Yeah.
I went around then.
Yeah. So Nas obviously had Emmanuel Stewart, and he had Oscar Suarez as well.
Yeah.
So how do you think that disrupted him? Because what I want is sort of your opinion of when a fighter's got two voices, two trainers in the camp. I know you've seen it a few times. Can it work or does it not work?
The trouble with Nas, I suppose, on that fight there, I think he was more loyal to Oscar.
Yeah.
And Manny's got the experience and the know-how, yeah, and the brain. So I think, you know, he wanted the two together. But to me personally, I probably wouldn't have had that. I would have had one trainer and I'd say, you know, listen to two people in the world. Because I remember the fight, I was in the corner with him as well.
Yeah.
With the Barrera fight. And you know, Manny was going in one round. Oscar was going the next round. And they were saying what they thought, and it's two different voices, two different things, two different thoughts going in. So it can be confusing that for a fighter when you're in a corner there. And you need to hear one voice, the same voice you've heard through your training. You know, one voice not saying whatever he said goes. You know what I mean? So not saying Nasra listened, but he would have got a lot more, you know, from one voice. You know, they're both great trainers.
Yeah.
Manny's experience, but, you know, sometimes I was in that corner, I thought they were saying the wrong things, you know, sometimes, you know, they were saying things like, you were getting caught, you're not shooting your right hand through, the same things that he's not doing,
yeah,
not what he should be doing. Yeah. You know, that was my experience and my recollection of it, you know what I mean? And it's too confusing. You know,
was there anything in that camp, the Barrera camp, that led you to believe it was going to be a defeat, or was it just a normal sort of camp? I know I've heard Nas talking, and I think he had a bit of problem with an injury, and he had to drop a load of weight quite quickly. But was there anything in the camp that led you to believe, or did you just have that ultimate belief that it's Nas and he's going to find a way?
Yeah, I thought Nas would win.
Yeah.
I mean, you have to read your camp anyway, your training camp, unless you see something drastically different. You know, I thought Nas was going to deal with him, yeah, you know, and apparent in a few rounds into the fight that it was going to be a hard night.
Yeah.
But even then, you still think that Nas has still got that punch, you know, that can turn things around. But it didn't happen.
Do you think the Nas of a few years before that maybe beat Sanchez and some of the other guys, Kevin Kelly, do you think that Nas would have beat Barrera, or is it too difficult to say?
Well, you know, if I'm going off my philosophy, which is when... And that's not, this ain't disrespecting no other trainers, but me, myself, I couldn't do it with another trainer. I've done my best, and the trainer done their best as well,
yeah,
you know, to make that happen for me. He done his very best, but it was not his fault. It's nobody's fault. It's a situation that we're in, you know. And so if I go off that philosophy where if Nas stayed with Brendan Ingle, maybe things might be different, maybe. Who knows, you know, because I've had a conversation with Nas before about that, you know, if he stayed there, if he shouldn't have stayed there, you know, but Nas was a different fighter when he trained with somebody else, I know that much. Whether he was better for the better or the worse, I don't know, but, you know, he was a different fighter when he changed trainers. But, you know, Nas had his reasons to change. I asked him about that, which I won't go into. Yeah. He had his reasons why to change, you know, so, you know, fair play.
So we don't really see much of Nas now. How is he? Is he in a happy place? Is he good?
Yeah, he's always been in a good place. You know, I know he's big and everything else, you know, overweight and everything else, you know what I mean? But he's happy himself, in himself, you know, wherever he wants to do something about the weight, it's up to him. But he's decent. You know, I speak to him all the time still. You know, he'll ring up, he'll crack on about things, but he's been watching about me as well, you know what I mean? So, yeah, you know, we'll speak pretty regular. When he comes down here in Manchester, you know, we'll go some places, we'll go to the boxing or whatever as well.
So, Morris, the last trip I remember you going on with Nas is when you went to Jordan How long ago was that now?
Boy, it seems like ever ago that, you know what I mean? It's a while back, yeah.
So what was that like going to Jordan?
Yeah, that trip was good, just me and him there this time. Because all the time we went away, especially me, Clifton, and he was on training camps, we'd have a few, you know, the guys and his brothers. But this one was just me and him. So I went to Jordan and we had to go meet King Hussein, who's passed away at the moment as well. He died, but we had to go meet the King. So that was different.
Cool. When I think of you, Morris, so when people talk about you, they just usually talk about your career, British light heavyweight champion and that. And for me, I don't think you get the respect or the recognition that you deserve when it comes to training fighters. Yeah. Obviously, I know you well, and most people know you well, and you've trained British champions, European champions. You've been involved in world title fights. You took Carl to the world title. And two notable fights that stand out for me in your training career is Steve Foster versus...
Don't ask me.
I know it. I can't pronounce it. Kira Kosovan. Is that it? Yeah.
Yeah. Kira.
Yeah. It's late, Morris. Kira. How was it training Steve for that fight? Because that was a fight that no one wanted. No one wanted to fight him. He'd been over here a couple of times and beat a couple of British guys. He was a tough, tough man. He was a short guy, bald head. Like made out of rock. What was the thoughts when that fight was made?
Well, we got told everything we knew about him, and we knew that he was tough and he's beat everybody in Britain, and we knew that it's going to be a hard night. So Steve had to be in the very, very best shape, you know, he could possibly get, and I know Steve Foster Jr. And when Steve Foster Jr. trains, people will tell you that he trains hard already. Yeah. But if I get him training just a little bit more harder, you know, just getting the right moves. And the thing was, you know, he had a bit of pressure on him as well, because Sky at the moment, at the time, they were following him around, you know, so they'd done a documentary on him. Why did he have to pick that fight? But it probably works out in his favor. You know, they followed him around for 3 months. And myself as well. So, you know, even if I wasn't confident, I had to sound confident that we're going to win the fight. You know, yeah. Because we're going into this hard fight and no one's beat this kid ever. You know, so, and he was looking for a world title fight, next fight. And we got the fight, so you have to take it.
How was Steve's mindset in training? Was he, because Steve was always a hard trainer, but did you notice for this fight, his big opportunity for the European title, he was putting that extra bit in?
Yeah, well, Steve, one of them guys, you know, he his dad used to train there. His dad obviously spoke to him and told him, you know, about the training methods there. That's why he came here in the first place.
Yeah.
He knew that I were messing around with him, and he just wanted to dedicate himself, and he did. He showed it in every single fight he had with me. Yeah. He trained. He's one of the best trainers, one of the easiest trainers as well, because, again, you know, that philosophy was put in him from early, you know, you do everything I say. You know what I mean? He's, you know, do it, and you win your fight. He's going over his chair, boy. Christmas was good, boy.
Yeah. So when Steve won the fight and he was European champion,
don't show Kyle Thompson this, boy. Oh boy, I tell you, man. I gotta try and keep it serious. might as well get another chair at this rate, Chris. You keep popping down.
Oh shit.
It's funny. Right, go on, man, I'm laughing, boy.
So when Steve won the European. Oh,
you trying to be serious now, Dan?
Just give me a sec.
Fuck it. Chair. Shit. Go on.
One sec.
Go on, I got you, man. I got you. Just look at that brandy there. It's getting rubbed anyway, isn't it?
Yeah. How's this position, Chris? Sorry. Yeah. Okay, you ready?
Yeah.
So when Steve won the European title, obviously, it's a very proud moment for you and proud moment for him. I mean, I remember the time. It was such a fantastic fight to watch because it sort of come out of nowhere a little bit, didn't it? It was a tough fight, and then Steve just catches him with that left hook, and you must have been ecstatic watching that.
Yeah. Because, I'd like to say, yeah, we trained for that. You know what I mean?
Yeah,
yeah. We trained for that punch, you know what I mean? But we never, you know, but what we did train for is a hard, hard fight.
Yeah.
So, with them kind of fighters there like that, they used to bullying people all over the place and you fall for it and you get bullied. So we always knew that, you know, Steve could match him for power.
Yeah.
You know, so Steve's favorite punch is left hook. So, you know, if he tries to bully, you got to bully him back.
Yeah.
You know, you can't let no one bully you like that in the ring. So otherwise, it's going to be a very hard night. So we always trained knowing that was never going to happen to Steve, you know what I mean? So he came and he got it, you know what I mean? As simple as that, really.
Was that fight right up your street? Like, it's the old champs camp way of whereas you're up against it, you're underdog, and you're just going to have to go out there and produce something.
Yeah, because they didn't believe that Steve was going to do that to him.
Yeah.
You know, they thought that, you know, Steve might nick it on points, but we didn't go for no points. You know, he came to give it Steve and to knock him out. He came like he's going to walk through him like he did to everybody else. And Steve never had none of it. And we trained exactly like that. And the good thing is about that as well, I can talk like this because I'm confident about this because it's happened. And also, Sky TV followed us for 3 months. They've seen the sparring. They've seen everything we've done, preparations. They've seen the morning work. They see how hard it was, the conditioning. You know, these guys, these new coming guys that are coming up in boxing these days, you know, they need to take a leaf out. Someone like Steve Foster's book there, you know, we trained for that fight, underdog for the fight, you know, no one give him a chance, you know, Carl Thompson with David A, you know, them kind of guys, you know, they, you know, take a leaf out of their book and look what they've done, you know what I mean? And they can overcome what's going on with hard work. And there's no other message apart from hard work and sacrifice.
So the Carl Thompson fight, where he fights David Hay, what was your thoughts when it got announced and when you're going into it? Again, it's another fight that you're an underdog in. People are expecting you to come up short. I mean, what's that training camp like? Because obviously I know Carl, I know yourself, quite stubborn, you want to prove people wrong.
Mm-hmm.
Was it that sort of feel to that sort of training camp?
Yeah, more so with David A, because we knew David is kind of arrogant, kind of approach guy, you know, he gives out that impression. And he took it more personal, you know, kind of thing, you know. And Carl was underdog and Carl was a champion. So we didn't like that one bit. And everything was for David A. Everything was for David's preparation, everything for David this, David that. And it's like, disregard what Carl's doing. Disregard who Carl Thompson is. So he had to be stubborn, like you say, and actually had to butt his way through everything, you know what I mean?
How concerned was you for Carl in the first round?
Very concerned. I was like the man on the chair there, the armchair, very, very, very concerned, you know. So when Carl came about, and, you know, because Carl's mindset is, like I said, he's stubborn. I always use that word for him. He's very stubborn. His mind is very, very strong. And no matter what you tell him, if his mind says something else, he's doing it, you know. But he never disagreed with me about anything.
Yeah.
Carl knew, because Carl was from the same school as me. So he knows, you know, he's done the training. He knows he's been there before.
Yeah.
He's been in that red zone a lot, you know what I mean? And he knows he can come through with that red zone. He knows that's where he wants to be. That's where when you get in that red zone, that's where Carl wants to be in training, in a fight, sorry. He wants to be in that red zone with you. So if you can't make it to that red zone, or if you got any ideas about coming out of that red zone, he'll take you there again. He always knew, you know, boxing. Phil used to say all the time, boxing is like a race, you know. You have to, if they're going there, you're going there. You have to keep taking it there, keep taking him there, keep taking it there. You know, and that's where we have to be with him. And in that first round, come out with David A, because of everything that went on before, which they probably didn't know, but it worked in our favour because that got Cal riled up, you know, and he got that riled up about it, and he knew that with everything that they thought he was an underdog, they thought he was old, they thought he was getting on, he's not going to make it past whatever. That's what spurs Cal's on, you know, he's a stubborn guy, you know.
Yeah.
And he proved it in that fight.
Your relationship with Carl, your training relationship, it seemed from the outside built on respect and trust. And I know that you respected and trusted Carl massively, and he respected and trusted you massively.
Yeah.
And I think he needed someone that knew him, because when I look at the Rothman fight, how close was you to pulling Carl out of that fight?
Very close.
Yeah.
Very close to pulling him out. I'm not saying I'm the best trainer out there. I know what I'm doing, everything else. I do know what I'm doing, but I'm not saying, you know. But in that fight there, we knew early on, simple boxing, you know, what Carl's got. And Carl can bang, you know what I mean, with his hands. And the very, very methodical, what's the word I'm looking for? What's the word I'm looking for, Chris? Methodical. That's the word.
Sound like Chris Eubank, man.
Yes, man. But his Carl's very methodical in his punching, you know what I mean?
Yeah,
so
yeah.
His punches are heavy. You know, they're not sharp and just heavy punches. So when you land, it's like a boom, boom. And I know that first stand, you know what I mean? They're like boom, they wear you down a lot, you know what I mean? So it's time to keep it simple with the punches. Yeah. Don't try. And it was, you know, left, right was the key for that fight. And he got through in the end.
So some fighters are difficult to train. You have to really drive them and motivate them to do things. And quite often you meet resistance. Carl wasn't like that. He's quite easy to train.
Yeah, Carl. Because he's been there with me when we used to train together. And, you know, with Carl, when Carl came to me, I knew Carl and Carl knew me. I didn't have to train him anything. I didn't have to show him things that he didn't know already. You know, we've tweaked him up and under certain things. But Carl's not the type of person where you say to him, two steps to your left, two steps to your right, and go for him. He's not that kind of a person, you know what I mean? Carl's a pressure fighter. So, you know, with pressure fighters, you got to work on the defense a lot, you know what I mean, because you don't want to get him to hurt either.
Do you think, sort of like nowadays, sometimes people are overcomplicating boxing a bit? Like, I look at some of the pad work going on out there, the fancy pad work, and people watch the Mayweather sort of stuff and that. Mm. Do you think sometimes it's getting overcomplicated, whereas if you've got a good defense, you've got a good jab, you've got a good right hand, that can take you places?
Yes, I mean, if I look at them kind of pad work, you know, if you know what you're doing it, what you're doing it for, maybe I can see reflexes for that, you know. Well, fair enough, but what I see a lot of it is fashion based, you know, just want to look good. Yeah. And usually see him throwing a combo, but the combo is usually never longer than 30 seconds, you know what I mean? And he's not going to fight like that. I think since Mayweather come on the scene and started showing you what he's doing in his training, which obviously he's doing it for a reason because he's been doing it for a kid, you know. But these guys are thinking this is the way to be now. I mean, I never seen Muhammad Ali on pads, have you?
No.
You know, so, you know, what do you need? You know, come on. You know, so I don't know anyway.
What would your advice to be someone that's young and coming up an amateur look, switch off the YouTube and get to the basics, get your footwork in order and stop worrying about kind of trying to replicate what people like Mayweather are doing?
I'd look at old fights. You know, if I was looking at any fights, I'd look at old fights. And you talk to anybody, any fighter that's made up there, they look at older fighters, not saying old fights, they look at fights that are older than them, you know, and they look and they learn the business. Learn your business. Don't think you're going to come there and, you know, you flash shorts and flash tassels and everything else and hands down and everything else. Learn your business first. Make sure you learn your business. And, you know, you don't have to stay with one person to learn your business. You know what I mean? You don't have to do that at all. But when I say stay with one person, I don't mean get all your advice.
Yeah.
So, I mean, because in boxing these days, you know, you've got people which I touch on a little bit, where you have amateurs, and when they turn pro, they go somewhere else.
Yeah.
I was saying in my career here, loyalty is a big thing in boxing for me, and there's not enough of it in boxing. There's, you know.
But do you look at, like, so I've got two thoughts, and obviously I love loyalty, but is this sometimes where loyalty is bad for a fighter? So if fighters with a trainer, and that trainer's not getting the best out of him. Is he right to move? Or the fighters that say, well, this is like a job. I've got a 10-year career. I need to do what's best for me. I need to just move and it's like a job. Or do you just think that, no, loyalty is loyalty. You stay with your trainer.
No, I say loyalty is all right if he's working out for you.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? If they're 100% happy, you know, if he's 100% happy trainer, if the training is 100% happy, the boxer is 100% happy. Obviously, things are working out. That's my case, you know. But, you know, if you're loyal with your trainer and then your trainer, you don't think you're getting the best out of your trainer, then for you to have words with him, and you can go amicably, that's fine.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? But guys that just switch from jump ship, and this trainer, I've seen it before, I won't mention no names, I've seen it where you have boxers, and that trainer will give that boxer everything. And even though that boxer, you might not think he's worthy of everything, you know, but he'll give him everything because he's a trainer, and that's your job, that's what you do. You give him 110%, and then the boxer just takes, and then one day he just decides to jump ship.
Yeah.
Now, that don't stick in my book, that. You know what I mean? That don't work at all. But that tells me a lot about the person then.
Yeah.
You know, who is the boxer. That tells me a lot about him. So he's probably not worth you having your time with him anyway.
Well, what do you think about, I mean, I'm not sure what it was like back in the day in your sort of early career, but seems to be like a lot of poaching going on.
Back in the day.
Back in the day, yeah.
Back in the day.
But when you get a pint of milk for 20p. So you took Steve to the European title, you took Carl to the European title. There's a lot of similarities in them fights because there's both sort of underdogs and that. Which fight, I mean, probably not fair, but which fight's the biggest accomplishment? Do you think Steve's or do you think Carl's?
I'm not going to offend anybody, but I say they're both different accomplishments in their own right, really, you know, because, you know, Steve was... It was great that fight because, you know, there's so much expectation from that fight.
Yeah.
You know, for Steve and myself and everyone else around us. And with Carl's fight, you're talking about, which one are you talking about?
David A.
David A fight? Yeah. Well, David A fight, you know, he was expected to lose that fight.
Yeah.
He was an underdog. I don't know why he was an underdog. Everybody written Carl off from the fight before that with Sebastian Rothman.
Yeah.
And this fight was definitely going to get beat by this up-and-coming cruiserweight star, you know, so, David A.
So the day after the David A fight, Carl has one more fight and then he retires. What was the reason for that?
Well, you know, when he fought David A, he's 41, you know, so, you know, there's not a lot of guys fighting at that age, cruiserweight, maybe heavyweight sometimes, you know what I mean? But, you know, so when you're doing things in the gym that you can't do no longer, you know, the bones start creaking and, you know, things start, you know, not working out as you want them to work out. The time start getting a bit, you know, it's time to call it a day. Be honest with yourself, you know, this game's young man's sport, really, you know, and especially when you're taking the shots. Carl's a pressure fighter, he's taking a lot of shots and, you know, was giving a lot out as well, but it's time to call it a day, you know, when it's time to, you know, you have to call it a day.
Was it a decision that everyone was comfortable with?
Yeah, you know, we spoke about it briefly and it started to come apparent, you know, because we've known Carl from a younger age and we know what he's capable of and what he's, you know, when things start creeping in, you know, it's time to go. And, you know, he's achieved what most people don't achieve in boxing, Carl. You know, he's one of the great fighters of the game.
So you're sparring with Carl. Spoke to Carl the other week.
Yeah.
Said kind of conflicts in the stories.
Yeah, this is see me now. Carl's a bit punchy, you see, because the way he's talking about me, like I'm not.
I tried to defend you, Morris, man.
Yeah. No, I got respect for Carl. You know, so back in the day. I won't say the good old days. Back in the day when me and Carl were fighting. Yeah, back in the day when me and him were sparring, you know, when Carl first came to the gym,
yeah,
it was good because I was beating the shit out of him then, which is great, you know. No, it was good because, you know, he'll admit it as well, you know, because he came to the gym and I was proving that there's only one lightweight at the gym. And every time Phil kept saying to him, you caught one, Cal? And I was like, no, show him that there's only one bus around here.
Yeah.
But then Carl started getting his look on his face and his character started saying to Phil that he's losing muscle, he's losing, all his excuses started coming out. That is, so he had to put on his weight and he started putting on weight and then, boy, I was getting that conversation off Phil then, you caught one, Morris. then things started turning around and yeah. Then in the end, I had to start bringing in sparring partners because that boy can punch, boy. I tell you, I give it him, he can punch him.
Yeah. So did you spar a lot? Was you a sort of fight that needed to spar a lot to get your time in? And do you believe in tough sparring?
I believe in the right sparring. You know, you don't necessarily have to be tough, but it's the right sparring. You know, if you're fighting someone fast, you want someone lighter, really, to spar with, you know, to move around.
Yeah.
You know, it depends. You have to have the right sparring.
Yeah.
You know, so sometimes it's got to be tough. Sometimes it gets tough in there. You know, sometimes you have to test yourself and you have to bring yourself to that red because... Like I said to that red about that red before, when you bring yourself to that red, you know, that's one thing with Carl Thompson. He had to go to red every single time he was training in a fight. And it's not that he had to go to red so much. It's more that he did go to red. He made sure that he'd done it properly, prepared himself. You know, what's the word looking for, Chris? Meticulously. So... He had to prepare himself, you know. So, you know, once he gets there and he knows he can go there, you know, it brings that edge in your fight, you know, because when you go there, you have to bring him there as well. And if you ain't prepared right, you're going to find out.
So the Jim Morris, we try and keep it as much as we can, like it was when Phil was there. Obviously, there's a few changes there has to be. But one thing that doesn't seem to change in the gym is kind of Phil's code of conduct. And I've spoken to you before and I can see you now or I can hear you now in my head addressing situations, thinking, how would Phil have handled this? He's very much present, isn't he, in the gym like that?
Yeah, I mean, I've always lived by his conduct, especially in the gym. And I always, I'm like you just said there, I'll always say to myself, you know, what would Phil do? And I'll say that before. Any situation. I mean, Anil's over there, right? Anil came to me when I first met Anil years ago. And Anil remember this, you know, back me up. Anil came to me and asked me to use the gym to do some filming. And I don't know Anil. Anil didn't know me. He just came down. And so I thought about it. And at that time as well, we were pretty struggling for money as well. And I remember Phil always saying to me, if you can help someone, help them. And also, we always said, if someone offers to help you, take it. You know what I mean? I always said that. Don't be too proud. So I said to him, I'll tell you what, come back next day. And he did. He come back the next day. And I said, we'll talk then. And he came back, and I thought about it. And I thought what Phil would have done. And I said to him, you know what? Fuck it. Come on. Just do it, man. Just use it. So Anil was over the moon with that. Then Anil in turn then said to me, come out and we'll go for something to eat and we'll talk about things. And I said, okay, I weren't too particularly needed any kind of present for what I was doing. I just said, you know, just come and use it. And I went out for a meal and then it says, all right. And then he said to me, come back to my office and meet some of the cast. And I went there and I met some of the cast back to his office and... To my great surprise, man, a girl was there who I'd been chasing for years, boy. I was chasing down that girl, man. And she's one of the cast. And I says, I don't believe this, man. I don't believe this, boy.
Of course you can use a gym.
And that was it. Anything else I can do? Yeah, so. And that was it. I got together with this girl, you know what I mean? Neil was the best thing ever for me, you know what I mean? Yeah. So, isn't that true, Neil?
That's true,
yeah. True, man. It's so you see how things work out, you know? So, work out well.
Might not have been the best thing that happened to you.
It wasn't in the long run.
Phil had a no-return policy, so if a fighter left the gym, he couldn't come back. I mean, you've always upheld that, but how kind of difficult may that be or tempting? If you had a top-class fighter and he decided to go elsewhere and you want to come back, you still go by Phil's code of conduct.
Always said it. I'm 100% with Phil.
Yeah.
No matter what's going on, it's the right move to make. If they're leaving, they're leaving for a reason. If you're leaving that gym, you're leaving for a reason.
Yeah.
If you're going to leave and you've made that decision, you've thought about it, you obviously thought about things, you know what I mean? And so you go and, you know, you don't have to fall out about it. You just go, but you know that if you go, there's no coming back.
Yeah.
Why are you coming back? You know, why are you going to come back? Is it not good enough out there for you? Is it, have you found out different? You know, for you to leave in the first place, there's got to be something wrong in the first place.
Yeah.
And that's where I look here. And Phil's conduct is right.
For me, so boxing's a small part of the gym. Mm-hmm. So obviously we have the amateurs and we've had the pros and that, but the people you see that it helps on a day-to-day basis, that's a real kind of beauty of this gym for me. It's helped hundreds and thousands of people, and Phil's been gone for nearly 30 years.
Yeah.
It's incredible. I mean, you must be proud of carrying on his legacy and the gym's legacy like that.
Yeah, of course. I love to be here, like I said to you before. It keeps me alive, keeps me who I am. And I love to be here when I people come in daily, weekly, whatever, and they tell me a story about Phil. I'm not here. This is years. How many years? It's 20-odd years later. People are still telling me things, and it just brings me back alive again, you know, when people tell me these stories. And I still think, what impact did Phil have on these people's lives? And I didn't even realize at the time when he was alive that he was doing all these things. You know, it's afterwards. I remember at the funeral, I was thinking to myself, Phil didn't really know how much respect he had, you know, until his funeral. And when you see people like Frank Warren, all them boys turning up, you know, from the mainstream, people that wouldn't, but, you know. Anyway.
We had, like, there's a class on tonight, and if you look at the class, like, the age of everyone in there, most of them wouldn't have been born when Phil was about, and they're still benefiting from him.
Yeah.
It's incredible, but... In the gym, your role extends to obviously you're the trainer, you run the gym, but you're also like a mentor to people. You can be a counselor, you can be a friend, and you can offer sound advice to people. How important do you think the gym is for people's lives and mental health? Because I know sort of during COVID, speaking to some people, they really struggled not coming to the gym.
Yeah, a lot of them did come to the gym as well because I was opening the gym. know, so... So, you know, but, you know, I had guys, I'm not trying to say, I had guys there, you know, calling me up. Some people are popular guys, you know, calling me up and telling me that, you know, the mental health, I know it's the fashionable thing to say, the mental health, but, you know, they were serious and they called me and they texted me in late at night and I couldn't understand. And me, myself being in here, I mean, look, everyone struggled in lockdown, you know, let's get it right. Nobody was going through this plain sailing. Everyone struggled at some point or another. You know, how severe it was is another story. So, including myself, you know, I'm not saying I was mental or anything like that. I was okay. I had the gym, and I knew this place was... I was coming here on my own and training on my own. It wasn't right. I used to blast the music out just to try and get some normality about the thing. And then people started coming in, and then more people started coming in. It turned out to be really good for everybody. And... I used to listen to what people say to me, and they were saying, look, if it wasn't for the gym, just that, you know, short 2 hours in here, they didn't want to go home, you know, because it just boosts them right up there, then they come back the next day. So the gym is more than just a boxing club.
Yeah.
You know, it's a safe haven. It's a social club. It's mentally make you strong, you know, not just for boxing, in life and what everything life has to throw at you as well.
It's quite corny because people use the term family a lot, but when I think of the gym, it really is a family. You get people coming in, they've got all sorts of problems, amount of things going on in their personal lives. There's always people there to listen and talk, and obviously everyone's there for the common interest of training and getting fit. I mean, how do you kind of maintain a positive mindset in your own life? Because you're quite a positive person. Would you put that down to training, or is it down to what you say, like the gym helping other people?
Well, like I could go back to Phil. You know, Phil taught me a lot of stuff. And I look at Phil's life and look at where Phil was with things. And he was positive, you know, and he showed me a lot of stuff. And I was around him a long, long time. If I wasn't around him a long, long time, I don't know what I'd been doing. I won't say I'd be in jail or something like that, like they all say, you know, or whatever, hanging out with somebody. You know, but, you know, through life, I've got a lot of life experience. You know, like I said, I've been a lot of places. I've seen a lot of people. I've been all over the world. I'm lucky, very fortunate. I remember the first time I jumped on a plane when I went 18 years old. Mm-hmm. When I first time I jumped on a plane, and I was with Phil, and we were going to Holland, and I was boxing over there. And I remember him, I was walking down the runway to get on the plane, and he stopped me. He said, "Cole, listen." And he said, "You see this?" And he pointed at the plane and says, "Yeah." And he says, "This is going to change your life forever." That's what he said to me.
Yeah.
I was like, "Yeah, right." You know what I mean? And it did. It did change my life forever. It's the start of things, you know.
I think out of everyone I've spoke to, boxing's changed your life more than anyone else's. Because obviously you met Phil, and I'll always look at you as a product of Phil. So you met Phil, you went on to obviously do what you did and become a champion. Then you went with Naz, and then you've stayed in the gym. And it's just like, it's had such an effect. Like some people, professionals, they kind of dip the toe in, so they'll train amateur, go professional, then go and do something else. Literally, since you come in here, how old was you when you came in? 16?
Yeah.
Since 16, just boxing's just been your life, hasn't it?
Everything, yeah. You know, and considering that you didn't really want to, you didn't know what he was getting into in the first place. Yeah. You know, for me, I came here, I didn't really think, like I said, I didn't dream about boxing when I was a child. I didn't think I want to be world champion, I want to be Muhammad Ali or anything like that. I didn't think about boxing. I mean, I watched Muhammad Ali, but that's about it. I didn't think I was going to do anything.
Yeah.
And to achieve what I've achieved, I'm really proud of myself as well. And anybody that jumps in that ring, and they'll know exactly what I'm talking about, because, you know, the guts, the heart, and, you know, it proves who you are as a person. If you can jump in that ring, anybody, no matter what's going on in that ring, you can jump in there with a pair of shorts and a no top and in front of a crowd of people, you know, and box and have a go. You know, it proves what you are as a person, no matter what level you're in.
Yeah.
Proves you are who you are as a person and what you're capable of as well. But that's the start of things. The gym is more than just a gym for boxing or learning a trade. You know, it's a safe haven. It's a completely different mindset. When you're in there training, other people are training, your mind drifts off around the boxing. It's a great place to be. Mentally, it's a great place to be.
In your career, Maurice, you were paid well for some fights. Do you feel that you had the right guidance?
Yeah, let's get this one, man. Listen.
Listen, man. We're 18.
Right. This chair keeps popping down, boy. It's not me. It's not me and my weight, man. I tell you, it's not me.
You'll be sat the floor in a minute, man. Oh, shit. Right, what's it?
Boy. Oh, shit, boy. That's right, man.
You got to start laughing, Maurice, because that's going to kill me.
Fury. Joshua, watch out, boy. Fucking funkies.
So, Maurice, in your career, for some of the fights towards the end, you paid very handsomely. Do you feel like you had the right sort of advice and guidance of what to do with the money, or do you feel like you pretty much left to spend it as you wanted to?
Well, Phil always told us what to do. Mm-hmm. He always said it. but you know, we were just seeing what we wanted to see, you know what I mean, really, and we just wanted to do what we wanted to do at the end of the day. He advised us all the time and told us properties and things like that and what investment and whatever he told us, he did tell us. Because Phil was a full package. Phil wasn't just leaving to yourself, he was wanting to see what's going on back home as well.
Yeah.
I remember Phil when he was Tony Cubia, you know, when he was, we were amateurs and, no, we just turned pro. And Phil used to question all the time, was he doing his road work in the morning and all that kind of stuff? Lived in Bolton. And what Phil done, man, he's got up a few mornings out of the week and drove to Bolton in the morning just to see if Tony got up and done his road work.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? See, guys ain't doing that these days, things like that, you know, that are on you like this and that.
But Phil was ahead of his time. So back then, like the early 90s, he was taking your heart rates and stuff, wasn't he? He was ahead of his time in a lot of what he was doing with like the training techniques as well.
Yeah, Phil was well ahead of his time, you know, ahead.
Did he have a degree in sports science?
Yeah, he went to college as well, he went to uni, sorry.
Mm. Yeah, intelligent guy. Mm. So you still train yourself, you still keep fit, and you're in here most days hitting the bag.
I still train myself. Keeping fit is another story. But, you know, as you can tell by this chair, keep clinking down them, you know what I mean?
About to get a special chair.
Yeah, that's right, man. So yeah, I'm still doing my thing, still messing around and still doing my thing.
So what happened with the motorbike accident to stop you running? Because no, running was a big part of your training.
Yeah, running's the best, isn't it? So I was riding a motorbike and I was living in Sheffield, going back and forward Manchester over the Snake Pass, and then one day just tried to take this bend a bit wide and clipped this caravan thing and went over the top and then smashed up my leg, and then, you know, that was that. And then I ended up in hospital, and then my spleen was bleeding and all kind of things, and it's pretty bad really.
But you still play football, you can still play a bit of football.
Yeah, I do like intimate running, that kind of stuff, but going for a long run, I could probably do it, but then the next day I'd be like limping, like, you know.
Yeah. Mm. So we've talked about boxing and obviously the benefits it can bring to someone's life and that. Yeah. You've got a daughter, and your daughter turned around and said she wanted to box, and she wanted to box amateur and go into professional. What would your thoughts be? Would you advise her against it or to do it?
I say do it to find out. You know, some people don't want their kids boxing. You know, it's a choice, which I respect. But, you know, I say to her to do it to find out, yeah. And depending on how she is, you know, then I could advise her from that, you know. So, I mean, you're talking, amateur to professional is a big gap, you know. So let's see her go through one stage first. Then maybe look at moving on or moving away from it, you know.
Well, it's an interesting point. You say amateur and professional is a big gap, because I think that gap's narrowed now. In that, I think that, like, certainly even back when I was an amateur, you had to be someone to be professional. But now you're getting like white collar fighters turning professional. You're just getting anyone turning over. As long as you can sell tickets, seem to get an easy ride.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying to you. If you're an amateur and, you know, I'm going to say the big gap, I mean, starting out amateur, depends how you progress in your career. Yeah. You know, if you're not getting nowhere in your amateur career, don't make sense you turning professional. Yeah. Even though some people are geared more for the professional ring than the amateur or the state of boxing, because, Jesus, it's not me, you know. It's the cheap jazz boy. Anyway, so, you know, if you're going out to be a journeyman in the professional ranks, providing you can defend yourself and, you know, hold yourself up and don't get hurt, you know, go along, because that's your business, being a journeyman. Yeah. You know, but if you're getting hurt in the game, which you shouldn't be, you know, you got to really look at your state of where you're going to be at.
As a fighter, there was a saying in it, you're always the last to know when your time's up and you should retire. Do you think that, or do you think that you're the first to know but the last to admit it?
Probably that.
Yeah.
Probably that, yeah.
So you're known as sort of Phil's sort of golden child in the gym, like he was his favourite, that's what people say. Did Phil ever have to discipline you or took you out of the gym or anything?
Yeah, once I was in the change room there, and I was with this guy, and this guy's got a big mouth on him, and me and him had a little bit of, you know, a little fisticuff thing in the change room, and jumped on him kind of thing, and then he was fighting. And Phil come in, and I thought I'd be all right, because I'm Phil's golden boy, like you say, you know what I mean? And Phil went, Collins, get out of the gym. Don't come back. I was like, mate, I couldn't believe it. I couldn't believe he kicked me out of the gym. He's like, mate, what are you talking about? Me? He said, get out. He kicked me out of the gym, boy. I couldn't believe it. So that's what I'm saying about, you know, discipline. So he kicked me out of the gym, and I come back, tail between my legs, 2 weeks later. And asked him to come back, and they gave me a bit of a discipline. But, you know, it was all part of my learning progress as well, you know, so, you know, I didn't mind. But at the time, I really thought I really fucked up here, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Discipline is, Jim.
Yeah, and it's the thing on the wall, isn't it? Success means discipline.
That's right.
And it's probably the true statement. I used to read it as a kid, come in and read it as a kid.
We used to read it every day. He's in the change room there.
Yeah. Were they Phil's words or just something he got from somewhere else, do you think?
I think, I'm not sure. And that's the truth, I'm not sure. Because he brought it in and he's proud. So I don't know if he made it up himself. I'm not sure. But people come in and take pictures of that and take it away with them.
I've known people to get it printed out and put it on the wall and the fridge.
But it's a really good saying, though. It's a really good saying about him. And he sums up his gym as well.
Yeah.
And it's something like a philosophy, like a code.
Yeah.
You know, when you're in here now, you must, you know, these are what we abide by, this rule, this law.
Yeah.
And, you know, when you see some people coming in the gym now, when you see the boxing, how the boxing's gone, you know, like I said, you know, loyalty's gone, you know what I mean? Long time. And some people think they're better than what they are. Like they say, you know, you're driving a Porsche already, you're driving it, you know. And some people are there for the wrong reasons, you know. So true fighters, you know, true fighters will come out in the end, you know. So it's like these days I see a lot of bumped up records, people fighting, not fighting nobody. You usually get found out in the end, or you usually get found out if you can fight, they will have to fight, you know. You can't go through 15-0 record with 15 knockouts and not fight nobody, you know. But that's what they try and do, protect your fighter, you know, these days, instead of, I know we're going off
talking about now,
but people are not trying to make the fights, you know. They probably want to see certain fights, and everyone knows what they want to see, but now, because it's so much of a business, you know, people are not making these fights happen. And it's usually the boxers will fight each other. The fighters will fight, I'll fight you, they'll fight me. Yeah. But it's not them, it's behind them.
Is it hard to be a fan of the sport when you know the politics behind it and you sort of compare it to how it was back in your day?
Well, what I've read in the older days.
Yeah, back when it was 15 rounds.
Yeah, because, you know, if you're back in the day, Jesus Christ, man. It's kind of that bad with this chair. So back in the day, you know, what can I say? There's so much money involved in boxing now.
Yeah.
You know, what we were getting paid for title fights is nothing what they're getting paid now for title fights. You know, it's understand me. It's a lot more money involved. So therefore, the business is a bit more screwed, you know what I mean? So a bit more serious. But people, at the end of the day, want to see fights. And if them two fights can't be made, I just don't see the point.
Yeah.
You know, there's that many belts in boxing now. You know, they need to narrow it right down because everyone's making a little book there or two. Some of the belts I've never heard of before. Yeah. I don't know what it means in the rankings either. You know, so there's just too many people picking in little things. They need to narrow it right down to get back to real fighting because they're losing the sense of, you know, other sports are coming in, MMA's in there, you know. You know, other sports are coming in, taking over.
Yeah.
You know, I don't think they'll ever take over boxing, but they're trying their best to take it over.
So how would you sum up your career, your fighting career? Cut short, happy with what you achieved?
One thing I'm happy about, that going back to Phil, is that I was undefeated with Phil in professional until Phil died. And as soon as Phil died, I lost my fight, you know. But I'm happy about that because he wasn't there to witness it, you know, and everything he'd done, I lived by, you know, and I'm 100% with Phil about everything and his philosophy, his ways, everything, you know. So, you know, after the fight, it's nobody's fault. He died. I wasn't ready for the fights. What I had after that, well, a couple of them, and it happened. But it made me go to a level where I wasn't intending on going, but I had to go. And so I moved on. I mean, I've had some pretty good boxers who have trained, champions who have trained.
Yeah.
So, you know, more than a lot of people have had in their own career.
Yeah.
You know, so, you know, I'm happy for everything that's happened. But I don't really try to knock the way life's thrown at me. I don't really try to knock that because I've had a good time.
Yeah.
So who would have known if I would have carried on boxing, what would have gone on, you know? But what's happened since, you know, like I said to you, all the meeting different fighters, all the Nas stories there,
yeah.
All the, you know, been to places there with him just alone that I would never gone. You know, I wouldn't go to Yemen. I definitely wouldn't go there now. There's a war in there, you know? So, you know, I wouldn't have gone see King this or whoever, Prime Minister that, or all these Supes and Michael Jacksons and, you know, yeah. Puff Daddies and all. I never seen all that, I don't think, you know what I mean? So, you know, Denzel Washington, you know, so, you know?
Like that, just a kid from South Manchester who went on a journey, and it's been one hell of a journey, hasn't it?
It's been great. It's been fantastic. You know, I could tell the story forever, you know, about what's going on. And, you know, a lot of people be fascinated by it. A lot of people, you know, something like this never happened to them.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And one of the stories, never mind all these stories, you know, so, you know, I've lived and I'm still living as well.
And anytime you talk about boxing or anything to do with boxing, it always gets brought back to Phil. And like I said during the whole podcast, Phil's just such a massive part of your life. The way you've devoted your life to kind of keep his legacy going and keep the gym going is commendable. And like I said earlier, you've turned down many opportunities to do it. And I know you come in every Christmas day, is it, to speak to Phil, and you think about him day in, day out. And I'm sure if Phil come back and saw what you'd done with the gym and how you kept it going and that, he'd be very, very proud.
He would be at most of it. Some of the things he wouldn't be. You know what I mean?
Well, he might chuck you out again.
I'd say he might just kick me out again, yeah.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? But no, on a serious note, he would be, you know, because, you know, we're here. Not just me, there's other people behind the scenes as well that are doing it, you know, and are keeping Phil's name alive as well. So, you know, I'll always be grateful for what Phil's done for me for the rest of my life. And that's come apparent that, you know, because that's why I'm never leaving this place.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And when I leave this place, the place will be closed and that was it. You know, but I don't know who's going to take over next, if that's going to go on. And it's not like I'm looking for someone to speak about me the way I'm speaking about Phil. It's not that at all.
I was going to say, though, that will happen because obviously people hold you in high regard. And Phil was one of a kind and no one would ever compare to Phil. But what you're doing in there day in, day out, the long hours, the stress and stuff like that, it's paying off because you can see it with the popularity of the gym. But just wanted to touch on how difficult was it to keep it going, because there's times when obviously the gym didn't have as much money as what we probably would have wished for. Would be some difficult times?
Yeah, you know, we didn't know what was going on from year to year. Never mind. It was one time it was like 6 months at a time. We didn't know what was going on. You know, the rent, things and bills and everything else needed paying.
Yeah.
So, you know, we didn't know what was going to go on. I just knew that. But in here, you must feel it yourself.
Yeah.
Phil's presence in here still.
I feel like I know him.
You know what I mean? That's what I'm saying. He's in here all the time as far as I'm concerned. This is the place where he is. I feel it, you know. I'm not saying I feel like shaking like this. You know what I mean? But I know that he's there. I always talk to Phil. I always will. Yeah. You know, people that have been here, they always tell me stories how they think. And Joe Gallagher, you know, he goes to Phil's grave. With, you know, every year, or when he gets a new belt. He still does it now, 20 odd years later. You know, they're grateful, eternally grateful for everything he's done for them. And this is a man that's passed away 20 odd years ago, nearly 30 years ago.
I never met Phil, but he's influenced my life amazing, because when I come to gym, like I said, I had a special feel. Never got to meet Phil, but I got the next best thing. I got Steve Alogba, Ozzy Maddox, Freddie John.
Oh, products of Phil.
And they passed it on to me, and hopefully I can pass it on to other people. And obviously speaking to you in here for years and years, and it's true, you feel the presence between rounds, you look at the pictures, you listen to the stories, and I feel like if you come in here, I'd be able to probably hold a conversation with him. But it's just, obviously, we've been over it many times, but it's just tragic that his project, should I say, or his mission got kind of cut short. But all we can do is, or all you can do, and the rest of the people in there is just keep it going.
And that's all we intend on doing, you know. That's what my intention is anyway, to keep it going and see what happens from them. But like you say, we're looking for that statue to get put up, you know, which it will. It'll get put up in Alexander Park. That would be great for the community, that, you know, and to let him show you that what Phil, because people know what Phil, and I guarantee you, when they see the statue, they go, oh, yeah, and everyone will have a story about him.
Yeah.
They all remember him, because all the guys now, from when we were younger, they're growing up now. They've grown up now, and they'll come to me and tell me all kind of things about Phil I didn't even know. And I, like I said, I love to hear them stories.
Yeah.
And that's what I mean, just to, you know.
Well, hopefully we've had the documentary, which was a massive hit. Everyone loved it, and Phil's getting the recognition. And hopefully now we can get the statue up, and he'll be there forever.
Yep.
So thanks a lot, Morris. It's been interesting. We could have probably stayed for another hour or so to do it, but
you could have.
I know you're shy, retiring type, and you don't like talking.
Listen, I ain't staying no more on this chair because this chair keeps popping out, man. It's showing me my weight. What I am now,
Morris.
Know what I mean?
It's the chair that's asking for it to be over, man. Chair's like, please, I'm on my last legs. Yeah.
I don't know if it's a chair or if it's Phil. You know what I mean? He's popping up like this.
What are you weighing nowadays? Just out of curiosity.
Well, last time I weighed, it was like 13.
How did you get down to like heavyweight?
How?
Yeah.
You know what's good about that? You know, making the weight? Because we're always training.
Yeah.
So it was always around the weight anyway.
Yeah.
Always around the weight. Just when you stop training, you recognise a little bit more.
The good old days, eh?
Right, it's all right, though, man. It's all right, man.
Thanks a lot, Morris. It's been a pleasure, right?
Can you just say one more thing?
Of course you can.
Carl Thompson. I'm coming for you.
Morris is going to outwork you, man. He says you can't do the work, so no worries.
You can't do the work. Ask Carl about this. He came down here, trying to give it a big in. He said he wants to go in a bag. He said, we'll go in a bag then, Carl. How many rounds? He said, 10. I said, I'll do 6, Carl. Then he said, no, Morris, 10. I'm winding him up. I know I can do 10, especially at his pace. So I've done the 10 rounds. And then the last round, I say, but Cal, is that it? Is that you got, Cal? And he's trying his best. He couldn't even answer me. He was that knackered.
I'm going to get you in the ring and see him be like Apollo versus Rocky.
Come on, Creed.
Right, Morris, thanks a lot once again, yeah?
All right, then.
Cheers.
Nice one.